Joining you from Earl E. Wilson Stadium here on the campus of UNLV for the final game of the opening set of the 2022 campaign as the UNLV Rebels look to avenge a doubleheader sweep at the hands of the visiting Michigan State Spartans yesterday. The Rebels, after winning game one of the series by a 4-2 final, dropped both ends of the twin bill yesterday, 10-6 in game one. It was 12-6 in game two. Rebels with a win today could split the series, the all-time series, still a 7-5 lead for the Rebels. It'll be Josh Sharman making his first outing of the 2022 season this afternoon. Sharman, the Las Vegas native, one of two Sharman brothers in the lineup today. Last year, Josh, a 1-4 record and a 5.69 ERA, turned it on down the back stretch of the year, starting 11 games in total, over 55 and a third innings. He gave up 37 runs, 35 earned, while striking out 26 batters. The Rebels going with their scarlet tops today with the white pants and the black caps on top, UNLV in white letters going across the top. The defense behind Sharman prior to the first pitch, with Eric Bajani making his third start, fourth appearance of the four-game series, doing the catching this afternoon. Hank Zeisler at first base. Diego Alarcon opposite him at the third base position. Gianni Horvat at short, with the Darian Williams playing at second base for the fourth straight game. The outfield left to right, Austin Krizik, Rylan Charles, and Jason Sharman, the older brother of Josh, on the mound by 1 year. Our umpiring crew today comprised of John Cascato behind the plate calling balls and strikes. It's Alberto Ruiz down the first baseline. Michael Blincy at second, currently stationed in the outfield with Dax Upton down the third baseline. And leading things off for Michigan State, Trent Farquhar, the second baseman. Left-handed batter takes a big looping curveball, missing down low. Underway at 12:04 here on a Sunday afternoon, 64 degrees at the time of first pitch. Another picture-perfect ball game here at UNLV. Sharman's pitch inside, a fastball called for ball two. Farquhar, the second baseman, has batted at the top of the lineup here in all four games of the set now. Farquhar, a 272 hitter a year ago. He's 4 of 14 to get the season started. Alarcon over at third, even with the bag. Third pitch is the first strike, a fastball on the knees and low. A ball, or two balls and one strike, the count to Farquhar, the leadoff batter. Jake Boss, the 14th-year head coach for the Michigan State Spartans, sending out a similar lineup here in the final game. As Farquhar, it's a two-hopper right into the glove of Diego Alarcon, who fielded it on a knee. Fire across the diamond is in time, received by Hank Zeisler over at first base. A 5-3 ground out to get the ball game started. So far, so good for Josh Sharman. One up and one away. Here's Mitch Jeb.
Number 14, Mitch
Jeb, the shortstop, batting from the left side. It's Zaid Walker, the right fielder, awaiting on deck in the three-hole in the lineup. Jack Frank, the center fielder, who homered in game one of the set, will bat fifth. Left-on-left matchup is Jeb squared to bunt and it's just inside. He pulled it back in time. Casey Mays, the left fielder, batting fifth. Peter Ahn, the designated hitter today, batting sixth, with Brian Brecker, the catcher, hitting out of the seven hole. Brock Vredenberg, big-bodied first baseman, in the penultimate spot in the lineup, with Dylan Kark, the third baseman, rounding up the starting nine for the visiting Michigan State Spartans. Sharman, graduate of Desert Oasis High School here in town, 5'11", 205-pound sophomore southpaw. His older brother, Jay, in right field, older by a year, the two of them Las Vegas natives, former bat boys for the Scarlet and Gray back in the day. Jeb takes down and inside, a running fastball moving towards the feet of the left-handed batter. Sharman throws it often, peppers in a changeup, and features a heavy looping curveball that'll move away from a lefty. Jeb so far in the series, 5 of 10, including 4 runs scored, a home run, and 3 more RBIs. There's the changeup, cutting back over the outer half of the plate, called for strike 2. Jeb, Big Ten all-freshman team a year ago. This is a young Michigan State roster, 28 freshmen and sophomores combined. Pitch taken for called strike 2. John Cascato calling balls and strikes behind home plate. The Rebels looking for a comeback today after falling in both ends of the twin bill yesterday. It was Nolan George taking the defeat in the nightcap after Noah Beal went 4 1/3 innings in a loss in game one. Sharman spins one downstairs. Pitch called for a ball. Count full at 3-2 to Jeb. Sharman last year, again, the 1-4 record and 5.69 ERA. An not necessarily indicative of the season as a whole. He was excellent down the backstretch. A number of Rebels really found their stride on both sides of the ball. Payoff offering misses down and away. Bajani down to the knees to keep it in front of him as Jem works the full count and then takes the walk for the game's first base runner here with one out in the top of the first inning.
Number three, Zaid Walker.
One out, one on for Walker. Right fielder who homered in game one yesterday. Walker, the top returner in the lineup for Jake Boss, the manager. 308 hitter a year ago with a trio of home runs. 31 runs batted in. Sharman out of the set, as he always is, takes a look to first base, fires to the dish. Walker laid around, fouls it into the right field bleacher seats. Good crowd on hand here on a Sunday afternoon. $2 tickets, plenty more of these Sunday home games upcoming. We've had some great crowd turnout here in the first weekend series of the 2022 season. Middle infield double play depth as Sharman lofts one over to first base. Back in standing is Jeb. He stole four bases a year ago. He's 2-for-3 already in this series. A lot of base runners and a lot of movement on the base paths for both sides, especially the Rebels when you compare it to their numbers from last year. 0-1 pitch ripped but foul as Zaid Walker pulls it beyond his third base coach. It's assistant coach Graham Sykes. Mark Vanamee, the pitching coach, with Andrew Stone serving currently beyond the first base bag. A couple of words for Mitch Jeb, who walked on a full count to get there. No balls and two strikes, the count from Sharman to Zaid Walker. Left on right matchup in the top of the very first frame. A look to first. Sharman will fire in that direction, diving back in and just able to get the right hand in his Jeb. So always tricky with the southpaws, especially a crafty lefty like Sharman who uses the gray area of the pickoff rule to his advantage. Pitch swung on, fouled up and out of play. That one will drift just shy of the clubhouse down the right field line. They're going to expect a lot out of Sharman today as the pitching staff was knocked around a bit yesterday. Going to need to stretch him at least five innings. Five pitchers used by the Rebels in game one yesterday, three more in the nightcap. Count remains nothing and two. The pitch to Walker. Swung on, line to center field. It's Ryland Charles charging. It drops in front of him. And that'll go for a base hit for Zaid Walker. Good piece of two-strike hitting. Just kind of stuck the bat head out and poked it right back where it came. Advancing up to second base is Jeb. Runners on first and second with one down here in the first inning. Double play positioning all the way around, especially in the middle infield with Gianni Horvat standing on the bag. Jack Frank due up. The center fielder in from the left. .266 average a year ago for Frank. He's having himself a great series. First pitch from Sharman. Curveball taken down low. One ball, no strikes. How the at-bat starts to Frank. 6-of-14 in the set. Had a two-run home run in the opening game. He's also scored five runs, the most out of any Michigan State batter. Johnny gives the sign. Sharman takes it and looks to second. Now deals to the plate on 1-0. A nicely spotted pitch that just clips the outer third. Good framing by Eric Bajani, the veteran catcher who has done a good job behind the plate. Cole Andovogi serving as the DH today. Got the start in game one yesterday. Bajani came in as a defensive replacement. No hold on at first. A big lead for Walker. Jeb bouncing around off the bag near second as Sharman will take a step off, fake a throw. Gianni Horvat, the shortstop who was covering, had moved back to his position. Third baseman Alarcon is off the line and behind the bag with the second baseman Adarian Williams away from it as well. The 1-1 offering, a curveball, hit on the ground, a one-hopper underneath the glove of the second baseman Williams. That'll sneak into right field. Rounding third, coming to the plate is Jeb. The throw cut off by Williams. And Michigan State, with back-to-back base hits following a walk, are on the board in the top of the first inning. RBI single for Jack Frank, his third run batted in of the set. Williams saw that one hit on him on a line. Plenty of side spin off the bat of the left-handed Frank. Tried to side caddy it and took that first bounce and stayed underneath. A two-base advancement for Walker as well. So runners on first and third after the RBI single. Casey Mays in from the left. A lot of southpaw batters here for Michigan State. Mays, the left fielder as well. Still one out, one to nothing here in the top of the first. First pitch swing underneath the backhanded attempt from Zeisler. Walker's going to touch it up from third easily. Frank rounding second. He's going for third. He's in without a throw. Make it three straight seeing eye singles through the infield. Back-to-back RBI hits for Frank and now Casey Mays. And all of a sudden, Michigan State ahead 2-0 early. Still one out, still with runners on the corners. A carousel early on as Peter Ahn digs in from the left side. Sharman picks the leg, fires to first. They've got the runner in a rundown. Mays caught between first and second. Keeping an eye on Frank at third. He's heading to the plate. The throw from Horvat is up the line. It gets past Bajani. Another run's going to score. Rounding second, heading to third is Mays. He'll be in standing up. It's 3-0 Michigan State in the top of the very first inning. Throwing error charge to Horvat as that one was way up the line. It's some of the toughest plays in baseball with runners on first and third. Not always a bad strategy to get in the rundown if you're the runner on first base, as Casey Mays proves to be the point there. He advances all the way to third as Frank's going to score on a throwing error from Horvat. With Eric Bajani now, the veteran leader here in this infield, calling everybody atop the mound. Not the start that UNLV would have hoped for, but let's take a look at that at this play again. So Sharman, a good pickoff move. No move back to the bag for Mace. He was trying to get into the rundown. Horvat grabbed it, looked at the runner, and a good throw may have had Jack Frank. Would have been a bang-bang play at the plate, but it goes up the line and sneaks past Eric Bajani for the third run in the top of the first inning. Trent Farquhar grounded out to start the game, and since then, Sharman struggling to get an out. Ahn, outfielder, serving as the designated hitter today, swings through the fastball high. Peter Ahn, spelled A-H-N. 6'2", 187-pounder out of Wisconsin. 3 of 10 so far in the series. A double in an RBI form. Goes down, swings over a curveball that bounces. He's behind nothing and two with a runner on third and one down. Diego Alarcon at third, even with the bag, but away from the line. Same story with Zeisler at first. Middle infield shaded deep. The outfield shaded to the left, playing on the opposite way in a left-on-left matchup. Ahn swings, grounds it right to Adarian Williams at second. He'll glove it and throw to first, but the run does score. Mays touching it up from third base is Ahn. Grounds out 4-3 on the scorecard, but earns credit for the RBI, and it's 4-0 Michigan State. Three singles, a walk, and a costly throwing error have given Michigan State four runs before UNLV records the third out of the first inning. It's Brian Brecker, the catcher in from the right. Big body backstop watches a pitch dropping right down the middle. Brecker, 1 of 8 so far in the series. Double and three RBIs, all coming yesterday. Infield's deep as Sharman gets a ground ball, hopped right to Gianni Horvat. Takes a step back as that one took a big bounce. High throw, glove by Zeisler. Damage done, though, in the top of the first inning. Overall, four runs on three hits. RBI singles from Jack Frank and Casey Mays got it started. Rebels come to bat for the first time, trailing by four. See if Ryland Charles can get something started when we return. We'll be back from Earl E. Wilson Stadium. Matt Neverett back from Earl E. Wilson Stadium here in the final game of the four-game series to kick off the 2022 campaign. The Rebels looking to even things up. They're going to need some bats to do it. Trailing, due up for the first time by a 4-0 score. Harrison Cook, the 6'5" right-hander, set to toe the slab for the visiting Michigan State Spartans, a 7-2 record and a 3.6 ERA a year ago at Iowa Western Community College, originally attended Kentucky and redshirted in the 2020 season. Cook facing off against Rylan Charles to lead things off. Charles playing in center field today with no James Gamble in the lineup for UNLV. Brian Brecker doing the catching today for Michigan State. Brock Vredenberg at first. It's Trent Farquhar currently in the shift, standing shallow in right field with Mitch Jeb at short, making up the three men on the right side of the infield. First pitch outside to Charles, called for ball one. It's Dylan Kark, the third baseman, creeping and away from the line. Big-bodied Harrison Cook looks in, takes the sign from Brecker, dealing out of the full windup here in the first. Charles takes a heater up and away. Count two balls and no strike to the Rebel leadoff man. And the outfield left to right for Michigan State, Casey Mays, Jack Frank, and Zaid Walker. Plenty of power in the bats of all three of them. 2-0 pitch misses up and away. Charles well ahead, three balls to no strikes in his first plate appearance, followed up by Diego Alarcon in the lineup playing at third. Austin Krizik making his fourth straight start, batting out of the three hole and playing in left. Tank Zeisler playing first and batting cleanup. Charles watches a four-pitch walk to get the bottom of the first inning started, flipping the bat towards the dugout before that pitch was even received by Brecker. So Charles finds a way on. He's got a steal and two tries already this year. Diego Alarcon working his way around to the right-handed batter's box, the third baseman with a home run and a pair of RBIs thus far in the set. Working out of the stretch here is Cook. Squaring to bunt is Alarcon. The pitch sneaks past the catcher, Brecker. Wild pitch advancing Charles to second. So a runner already in scoring position. If you're down four before you come to bat, a good start for the Rebels. Alarcon now with a runner in scoring position. Watches another fastball high. Six straight balls to start the game for Cook. Last year at Iowa Western, walked just 16 and struck out 68 over 50 innings. The catcher Brecker, young player as well, out to have a word with his starting pitcher. Six straight balls to get the game started. We'll finish the lineup while they're out meeting on top of the mound. Cole Andovogi batting in the fifth spot, serving as a designated hitter, making his second start of the set. His first at DH. Darian Williams, the second baseman, bats sixth with Eric Bajani, the catcher, hitting seventh. It's Jay Sharman playing in right, batting eighth with Gianni Horvat, as he's done all weekend, rounding out the lineup, batting ninth and playing it short as a true freshman. Alarcon was a big cog in the Rebels' offense last year, watching a curveball fading in for a strike. That one came through the inside for the first strike of the game for Cook. Alarcon was All-Mountain West last year. Preseason All-Mountain West again, one of three selections for the Rebels, along with Bajani and Williams. 2-1 pitch, same look, same call. Breaking ball that cuts in over the inner third for Cook. The fastballs were all missing in the same spot. He wasn't finishing. They were all up and away to the left-hander Charles and up and in to Alarcon, who's even now, two balls and two strikes. Pitch taken high. There's another breaking ball, but it stays up. Cook, after redshirting his freshman year at Kentucky, a 7-2 record and a 3.6 earned run average over 12 appearances last year at Iowa Western. Made 10 starts to the tune of 50 innings total. Alarcon chops one to the third baseman, scooped up by Dylan Kark on the short hop. Throw to first in plenty of time as one third baseman grounds out to the other. Charles, meanwhile, staying at second base. No way for him to advance on that ball right to the gut of Kark at third.
Number 47, Austin Krizik.
Austin Krizik batting now with runner on second, one down. Rebels still trailing 4-0. The fields deep with the exception of Farquhar guarding at second base. First pitch, a check swing. Look out. Almost some friendly fire as that ball went flying just over the heads of his battery mates. Nice grab made on the fly by a fan down the right field side. Cook originally from Solon, Iowa. He deals out of the stretch here to Krizik, who pulls it but foul right past the third base coach, Kevin Higgins. Spoke with Higgy pregame, said that you're going to need to change some of the approaches. Not a lot of guys working many counts, not many base on balls. Try to drive the pitch count up of these opposing arms. Krizik's as old school as they get. No batting gloves. He's standing close to the plate. No fear from the Rebel left fielder as he swings and misses over the 0-2 pitch in the dirt. The throw down from the catcher is in time. Brecker's shot retires Krizik. Strikeout score 2-3 on the putout. No advancement for Ryland Charles either as he stays at second. He walked on the first four pitches and moved to second on the very next pitch. A wild pitch that went past Brecker. A chance to expand the inning for Hank Zeisler. Looking to keep it going. He's 3-for-12 in his first appearances in the Scarlet and Gray. Transfer out of Chapman in Southern California, Division III school. He was a Division III All-Star. Takes a heater at the knees for a called strike. Chapman in his career, or rather Zeisler in his career at Chapman, a 334 batter, including a 375 batting average in his fourth and final year, the Division III school in Orange, California. 0-1 pitch at right back up the middle. Shaded that way was the shortstop, Jev. He'll glove, turn, and fire to first in plenty of time. Rebels get a runner on but are unable to advance him past second base. And after one inning of play, Michigan State on top by a 4-0 score. 8-9-1. Do up for the visitors when we return. Top two, Michigan State leading UNLV by a 4-0 score. It's 8-9-1 in the opposing lineup. Brock Vredenberg, Dylan Kark, and then Trent Farquhar up against Josh Sharman. The lefty was tagged for four runs on three hits. First pitch swinging is Vredenberg. Pulls it down the right field line. Fair. Straddling the line was the first base umpire. He saw it right away. Vredenberg rounds first. He's turning second, going for three. The throw from Adarian Williams is on target, but late. A leadoff triple for Brock Vredenberg on the first pitch in the second inning. Vredenberg, 6'7" first baseman, turned on that pitch. He went down and dug it out from the knees, and all of a sudden, Michigan State with another run 90 feet away from scoring in the form of Vredenberg, who's having himself a great series. Now the number 9 batter, Dylan Kark, due up for the first time. Third baseman watches one bounce in. Eric Bajani keeps it in front. Kark so far in the series, 1-of-6. This is just his third overall appearance. A left-on-right matchup here is Josh Sharman looks to quiet the seas. Lefty deals out of the stretch, bounces one in. Bajani's able to keep it near him. Bouncer that went off the chest of the Rebel backstop. Kark, a 216 batter a year ago. A sophomore out of White Lake, Michigan. A ton of Michigan players headed up to East Lansing to play their collegiate ball. Here's the 2-0 from Sharman. Swing and a chopper pulled foul. The Rebels in their half of the first inning. No runs on no hits. Ryland Charles reached on a base on balls, was advanced to second on a wild pitch. But ground out, a strikeout, and another ground out. Now the side was retired in the bottom of the first. Laid around on the heater is Dylan Kark as he popped this one high and out of plate on the right field side. A great story in the Scarlet and Gray Free Press about the Sharman brothers, from UNLV bat boys to players. The headline, here's the 2-2 from Josh. It's a tapper off the foot. They're going to call a foul ball right away. Kark right away felt that one. The umpire saw it. You can hear that, too. It's a complete different sound if you hit it straight down into the dirt versus if you hit it into your foot. It's more muffled. Left on right matchup. Here's the 2-2. Swung on. Another one pulled foul. Sharman going back to the well with that same spot. But in the article, Josh and Jason, obviously from Las Vegas, Desert Oasis High School grads, they grew up coming to Earl E. Wilson. They were big fans. Their dad very involved in the program, especially now that both of his sons are playing for him. This one's grounded, left side and fair. Past the diving Alarcon. Horvat scoops it up. Throw to first is in time. Vredenberg held up, took off from third as soon as Horvat fired. So it'll be an RBI ground out for Dylan Kark. It was a good effort from Diego Alarcon. Let's see just how close he was. As the number nine batter does the job, so to speak, just putting a ball in play, especially with the runner on third base. Zeisler had no shot, put it in the back pocket. The score now 5-0 with Michigan State on top. Kark given credit for his first RBI of the season. First pitch swinging is Trent Farquhar. 5'11 second baseman pops one foul and out of play down the left field side. Couple of players on the Michigan State roster today going old school with the stirrups. The green tops, the gray pants. Farquhar swings to the curveball, pulls it foul. Nice grab by Zeisler in foul territory. That shot was off the end of the bat by Farquhar. He grounds it out to Diego at third base to start the game. The next four batters reached and scored, followed by a Peter Ahn RBI groundout. 5-0, Michigan State on top. Middle third of the lineup due up for UNLV in the bottom of the frame. Farquhar watches one roll between the legs of the catcher, Bajani. No harm, no foul with nobody on base. But in the article, the Scarlet and Gray Free Press about the Sharman brothers, there were two brothers, the Armstrongs, on the Rebel team when they were bat boys. Really was the inspiration, they said, for staying home, both playing here at UNLV. Josh misses down and in. A two-ball, two-strike count. Josh pitching in his third season for the Scarlet and Gray. 2-1 record as a freshman. Swinging a foul ball, knocked straight back. Count two balls and two strikes to the leadoff man. Heading into this season, the career numbers for Sharman. 3-5 record in 15 appearances, all starts, and a 5.22 earned run average. At 2-2 pitches in the dirt, a good discerning batting eye from Farquhar as it's picked out by Bajani. That'll bring the count full, though. 3 balls, 2 strikes, 1 out in descending order on the video board beyond the left field fence. Waiting on deck is Jeb. He walked and scored, started the carousel in the first inning. Sharman set. Here's the 3-2 payoff. Swung on it right back to him. It tips off the pitcher. Gianni Horvat scoops it up, but nowhere to go for the shortstop. Sharman looks to be all right walking off the mound. Looked like it hit him somewhere in the midsection. He gives a thumbs up to the dugout. Always a scary situation on a foul ball straight back.
Looks like it got him in the quad. Great camera work down the first base side. Is if you're going to get hit by a comebacker, that may be the best spot. Charmin's going to have a nice bruise there, but he's able to stay in the game. Farquhar to first. Here's Jeb in from the left. Charmin fires over towards first base. Jeb heading into the day was 5 of 10. That's where he rests after his first at-bat ended in the base on balls. Ground ball, second base. Williams, gloves, Horvat, the turn at the bag, the fire to first, not in time. And that was about as quick as they could have been up the middle. It was a hot shot right to a Darian Williams, shaded perfectly away from the bag. And Horvat's got great hands, especially for a freshman, and a very strong arm. A fielder's choice, rather, a 4-6 put out at second base. Jeb hustling it out, beating the step barely. So Farquhar wiped down after his single, scored 4-6. Jeb reaches on a fielder's choice. So now two away, Zaid Walker in from the right. Right fielder swings at the first pitch and pops it straight back.
Now batting the right fielder, roller brings
a count nothing and one. Walker recorded the first hit for Michigan State. Shot one just underneath the glove of shortstop Giovanni Horvat. Walker's got four hits on the series, including a mammoth home run yesterday. Hits one on the ground to third. Diving on a backhand grab by Alarcon. Long throw across the diamond. Zeisler picks it out on a high hop. A web gem to end the inning, but another run tacked on. Vredenberg leads off with a triple, driven in by Dylan Kark, and a couple of great defensive plays cap it at a run. Cole Andovogi will lead things off in the bottom of the second when we return with the Rebels down 5-0. Intermountain Healthcare, here to be a part of your Las Vegas life, and more importantly, here to help you live an even healthier one. Intermountain Healthcare, official healthcare partner of UNLV Athletics. Another run added on for Michigan State in the top of the second inning. Currently up over UNLV by a 5-0 score. The comeback trail begins with Cole Andovolgi's first at bat. A designated hitter, making his second start of the series.
Number 43, Cole Andovolgi.
Andovolgi, the sophomore out of Moorpark, California, in the southern part of the state, in from the right side against Harrison Cook, who begins his second inning of work, firing the first pitch, missing just downstairs. 16th pitch of the afternoon for the starting pitcher, starts it out 1-0. Andovolgi, 6 feet tall, 205-pounder, residing in L.A., makes another pitch low, 2 balls and no strikes. It's Andovolgi, Williams, and Bajani. The first three batters for the home side here in the bottom of the second. Still no hits as Cook deals out of the full wind. Andovolgi takes low ahead, 3 balls and no strikes. Similar situation to Ryland Charles, the leadoff batter in the first inning. Charles watched 4 straight pitches, nearly all in the same spot. Fastball's high. His fastball's chest high, but in the zone. Andovolgi watching all the way on a 3-0 count. Working quickly with some tempo here is Cook. Andovolgi checks the swing. Called ball 4. Down and inside as Cook has now walked the leadoff batter of both frames. Charles made it up to second in the first on a wild pitch. See what happens with Andovolgi on the base paths. Here's the preseason All-Mountain West selection, Adarian Williams. Williams off to a slow start this year. Plenty of room here in this final game of the set. 1 of 10 with 5 strikeouts to start the year. And Volgi off first as Cook spins a slider in for a called strike. When he was losing his control earlier in the game, after throwing the first 6 pitches he fired for balls, he started throwing that spinning pitch, especially when Austin Krizek was in. He's featuring it often to right-handed batters. Reaches back on the fastball and gets Williams swinging. Count quickly, nothing and 2 to Adarian. Coming into the year ranked by D1 Baseball as the number 19 second baseman in all of college baseball. Williams holds the bat at chest level in from the right side. Here's the 0-2 pitch. Swung on and missed. Cook pulled the string on an off-speed look. His second punch out is the first out here in the bottom of the second inning. UNLV still trailing by 5.
The catcher, number 5, Eric Johnny.
With a runner on and one down, it's Eric Bajani batting from the right. 2 for 8 in the opening series of the year for the catcher. First pitch swinging, chops one to third, scoops up on a short hop by Clark, takes a look to second, smartly fires to first instead, retires Bajani with Andovolgi advancing from first to second base. Bajani doing the job, so to speak, moving the runner into scoring position. That was a nice play by Clark, not only to get around that one, but had to be quick with the throw, and he was.
Right fielder, number 35, Jason Sharman.
That'll bring up Jason Sharman. Sharman got a plate appearance as a pinch hitter last night in the second game. Stan Stolte and co. opened up the bench late. Got everybody in here in the early part of the season. Sharman watches a first pitch strike in there on a fastball, nodding in agreement. He was up there taking all the way on the first pitch. Jay Sharman, the older brother of Josh Sharman, today's starting pitcher. Of course, if you know the program at all, you've heard these two names. Jay takes a pitch down and inside to even up the count. Jason's listed at 5'11", 185. The junior, it was known more of a pitcher in high school than the two flipped as far as their predominant skill sets. Josh said that he was more of the power hitter in high school at Desert Oasis. Jay rolls one foul. Pulled it early. Behind 1-2 here in the home half of the second inning. Final game against Michigan State today before making the drive to St. George, Utah on Tuesday. A one-off game against Dixie State. A look back to second for Harrison Cook. He deals out of the stretch to the plate. Missing just off the inside. A good take there from Sharman. And the catcher Brecker holding it there for an extra half a second. Trying to bait the call out of the home plate umpire John Cascano, but no dice. Number 9 batter Giovanni Horvat awaits on deck. Meanwhile, the count 2-2 with a couple of outs and a runner on second here in the second inning. Cook deals. Sharman takes off the outside, called for ball 3. It saw a similar strike zone in game 2 last night with Dax Upton currently at third base behind the plate. It's tight but consistent. And I know I said it yesterday, but that's all you can ask for out of an umpiring crew, especially behind the plate. So here we go, the 3-2 payoff pitch. Swung on, ripped through the right side of the infield. Getting the wave to the plate is Andovolgi. The throw from the right fielder Walker is up the line, not in time. Scoring on the RBI single is Andovolgi, and Jay Sharman has the Rebels on the board. An excellent piece of two-strike hitting from Sharman. Choked up on the bat, rolling it swiftly through the right side of the infield. His number first hit of the year is his first RBI. Comeback trail. Officially started with the Sharman RBI hit. He's on first base with 2 down. And the true freshman Gianni Horvat steps in. 2 for 12 in his first college action, the true freshman out of Valencia in Southern California. Watching all the way on a breaking ball, misses outside. Begins the right-on-right matchup with a one-ball, no-strike count. Horvat did triple in the opening game yesterday. Plenty of speed from the shortstop who started every game so far. Gets this one off the hands, rolls it to the left side. Backhanded by the shortstop. Jeb, his throw to second, not in time. It was the only play he had with Sharman bearing down on the bag. Received by Farquhar, but a bit late. Fielder's choice will put Horvat on first base. Sharman in scoring position at second. It goes to show, honestly, what happens when you put the ball in play. With all the focus on what they are calling the three true results, a home run, a strikeout, or a walk, goes to show what putting the ball in play will do. We're back at the top of the lineup. Sixth hitter of the inning is Rylan Charles. First pitch swing and a rip, but he pulled it foul. Yanked it down the first baseline, jumping all over the first pitch. Charles walked in the first, took the first four pitches of the ball game. Advanced to second on the next one as Cook fired it past the catcher. Charles never advanced past second base. Three-man shift on the right side of the infield. Here's the 0-1. Chopped left side against the shift and through. A big bounce in the outfield will tell Sharman to head home. He's able to score, and it's a 5-2 score. Second RBI single of the inning. A little rollers through the infield. Charles goes the opposite way, and the Rebels are within three. RBI number 5 on the year for Charles. He had 9 all of last year.
Third baseman, Diego Alarcon.
And now all of a sudden, Diego Alarcon steps in, representing the game's tying run in the second inning. Two runs across on two base hits already in the inning. Alarcon grounded out to third in his only other plate appearance. Cook out of the stretch. Alarcon swings and misses at the high fastball. Taking a look at the defensive positioning, Vredenberg off the bag, no hold of Rylan Charles at first base, with Farquhar, the second baseman, shaded up the middle, keeping tabs on runner Horvat with a big lead. Alarcon checks the swing. They appeal. No, he did not, says the first base umpire Alberto Ruiz. Good bat control from Alarcon, who was tabbed as a preseason All-Mountain West selection. Wind blowing slightly in from straightaway center field here on a Sunday afternoon. Picture perfect day for baseball. Bouncing ball gets to the right of the catcher, Brecker. Advancing from second to third is Horvat on the wild pitch. No advancement from Charles off first, though. It was an immediate reaction from Gianni off the bag at second. So much to like from the young infielder out of Southern California. We talked with the coaching staff preseason. They said that they loved his quickness. Just his decision-making early on. Said he does not play like a freshman. He had a great fall. So did a number of the newcomers. Gavin Mez and Santino Panero, two names that were brought up. Alarcon rips one through the third baseman, Clark. And the run's going to score, making it a 5-3 ball game. Throw goes back to second. Charles standing on the bag safely. Another RBI hit, this time from Alarcon. It's his third ribby of the season. And the Rebels' bats waking up in the second inning. Timely hitting and situational hitting, two things that were not there in either end of the doubleheader yesterday. They're coming out in spades in the second. So Charles to second, Alarcon to first. They both reached on RBI hits. Austin Krizik, the eighth batter of the inning, stands in. Makes a changeup that tumbles through the top of the zone in for a called strike one. Krizik struck out on a pitch in the dirt back in the first inning. All of a sudden, the Rebels making Cook labor. Here comes his 39th pitch of the ballgame. Krizik takes a fastball he thought was outside. Instead, called for strike one. Rather, strike two with an 0-2 count. Two down and two on. In what is now a 5-3 ballgame. Right-hander Cook comes set with the glove held out in front of the chest. This one's hit up in the air. Heading back now in is Jack Frank, center fielder, still on the move, reaches up and makes the grab at the chest. The Rebels respond with three runs to the tune of three hits, RBI singles from Sharman, Charles, and Alarcon. And we've got ourselves a ball game. The Rebels fighting through two innings. We'll be back with the top of the third from Earl E. Wilson. Josh Sharman pitching with some support. Rebels still trailing, but it's by a 5-3 score. Three runs on three hits in the home half of the second inning have the Rebels back within striking distance. Sharman misses outside on the first pitch he throws. It's the center fielder Jack Frank batting from the left. Michigan State scored four in the first, tacked on another one in the second. This one's chopped to first. Nice grab on a short hop by Zeisler. The first baseman's going to win the foot race to the bag himself. Zeisler, as much as he's known for the bat, and that's his main calling card, he's been excellent with the glove early on, starting with the inter-squad scrimmage at the Meet the Rebels event last week. Zeisler, as capable a defender at first base as they come, and Frank sat down on what was an excellent play, a very, very tough hop from Zeisler. He made it look easy here to lead off the third inning. Brings in Casey Mays, the left-handed batting left fielder who singled and scored back in the four-run first. Able to check the swing, holding it there for an extra second. A bouncing ball called for ball one. It was Sharman, Charles, and Alarcon with the three RBI singles in the second inning. Sharman deals from the left side of the rubber, third base side. Drops a fastball in for a called strike. One ball, one strike, and one out to Mays. Seven hits and 14 at-bats in the series. He swings here, hits this one right to Adarian Williams. Second baseman charges. A quick throw to first is in time. Quickly two up and two away here in the third. If Sharman's able to go 1-2-3 here, would really right the ship with the momentum all on the Rebels' side thanks to the at-bats in the bottom of the second inning.
The designated hitter, Peter Ahn.
Nobody on ahead of Peter Ahn, the DH. He grounded out to second back in the first, but earned an RBI. Takes a bouncing ball and a running fastball down and inside. Ahn brought around Jack Frank from third base. Sharman hoping to go quick and easy through the third. Lifts the leg, fires with the left, a hot shot right to Zeisler. The first baseman makes another play. He'll win the race to the bag once again. So Josh Sharman, an excellent comeback effort in the third. Three ground outs, all to the right side, all without consequence. And the Rebels come to bat with all the momentum on their side. Guess who's leading off? It's Hank Zeisler. We'll be back with the Rebels looking to come back trailing 5-3. Sharman with an easy breezy top of the third, going 1-2-3 in the middle third of the UNLV lineup. Set to get things going. Matt Neverett welcoming you back to Earl E. Wilson Stadium. Final game of this four-game set. Zeisler grounded out to shorten his only other at-bat, but made two of the three outs all by himself in the top of the inning. A couple of great plays as he takes a pitch high and outside. Zeisler, a left-handed batter, 5'10", 215-pound senior. Originally from Kentfield in California. He's been a welcome addition here to this first base rotation. And running fastball moving away from him is called for a strike. Zeisler and Austin Pfeiffer figuring to take the majority, if not all, the reps at first base this season. But it's been Zeisler taking over early. He swings here, drives this one. High and deep to right. The right fielder turning around. He'll watch it go. Hank Zeisler has his first UNLV home run, and the Rebels back within a run, 5-4, here in the bottom of the third inning. A mammoth moonshot to right field for Hank Zeisler. He's got the flow going early in the season. And the home run hat atop the dome. Zeisler had 17 home runs in 4 years at Chapman. Gets his first one in the first series with UNLV. It's one of those ones immediately off the bat. I was clearing the fence in a hurry to right. Cole Andovolgi taking an aggressive attack at the first pitch. Pops it foul and out of play down the first base side. Couple of bodies up and moving around down the right field line. UNLV bullpen active. A right-hander up and tossing. Side-winding righty getting loose. Here's the 0-1 to Andovolgi. Fastball at the knees, a called strike. Andovolgi walked and scored the Rebels' first run back in the second inning. Checks the swing. And he's punched out, called for strike three. And Andovolgi leaning over the plate as that one broke from inside to outside. Nicely spotted pitch from Harrison Cook. So following up the Zeisler home run, the Andovolgi strikeout puts one out on the board. Nobody on ahead of Edarian Williams. He struck out swinging in the second, one of the three strikeouts for Cook thus far. First pitch swinging, a roller up the middle that sneaks through. Darian Williams will take it any way he can get it. His second hit in 12 at-bats to start the year. Rolls right back up the middle. And the UNLV bats have woken up in a major way in the second and third frames. Three runs on three hits in the second. Already a pair of knocks here in the third. Eric Bajani batting with the runner on. One down here in the home half of the third inning. First pitch swinging. He skies one to shallow right center. Blocking the sun with his glove is Jack Frank, the center fielder called off by the right fielder Walker, who makes the grab. Sunglasses on. Bajani now 0-for-2 with the ground out and a fly out to right for the second out in the third inning. Back to first is Adarian Williams. It brings up Jay Sharman.
Right fielder, Jason Sharman.
Plenty of action going on around the Mountain West with one game already final. The Fresno State Bulldogs dominating UC Riverside 17-2 earlier on in Fresno this morning. Quick throw to first base sends Williams back in scurrying. He's safe head first on the dive. Left-handed batting right fielder today swings, taps one off the end of the bat. Cook sticks the glove out. The pitcher will make the underhand flip to first base. But the Hank Zeisler leadoff home run has brought the Rebs back within a run. 5-4 after three innings of play. Bottom of the Michigan State lineup to get us going when we return for the fourth inning. Top of the fourth, we've got a big one on our hands. 5-4, Michigan State leading over the Rebels. It'll be a new arm into the game for the home side after three innings of Josh Sharman. It'll be the sidewinding righty Hayden Nierman. And maybe not. He was taking his final warm-up toss. Kind of fell off the side of the mound, and Stan Stolte, the manager, out now to have a word with him. And they're looking towards the dugout while Nierman points to his shoulder. He's heading to the dugout, so Hayden Nierman is not going to throw a pitch. He was warming up during the entirety of the last half inning. Came out, got his warm-up tosses in. And on the final one, kind of rolled off the side of the mound and pointed to the shoulder, his right throwing shoulder. So we'll have a new pitcher coming in to actually toss here in the fourth inning. He'll have as long as he needs to warm up due to the injury. It's Joey Acosta wearing number 19. Acosta, the new pitcher. So we'll step aside here again as Acosta is going to need a while to warm up. I think he saw Nierman potentially injure himself. Again, came off the mound pointing to the right shoulder. Left before throwing a pitch. And so Acosta's going to have as much time as he needs to warm up. We'll step aside. We'll give you the final numbers on Josh Sharman when we return. This is an interesting one. We'll be back to finally begin the top of the fourth inning when we return.
Due to injury to Hayden.
Joey Acosta getting his final warm-up tosses in. Ahead of his first pitch again, Hayden Nierman was warming up the entirety of the last inning. On his final warm-up toss, came up lame and was grabbing his shoulder. Stan Stolte, the manager, out. He pointed at the same spot. Nierman to the clubhouse immediately. So Joey Acosta coming in, the transfer from El Camino Community College in California, had as many warm-up tosses as he needed due to injury. First pitch following said warm-up tosses is a breaking ball, called for a ball down low to the catcher, Brian Brecker, who grounded out to short to wrap up the run-scoring first inning. Acosta, originally from Manhattan Beach in Southern California, deals from the right side. Nicely spotted heater on the outer half, called for strike one. Acosta, 6'3", 200-pound right-hander, works exclusively out of the stretch. Comes set with the left foot in front of the right and fires. Curveball taps straight down, a ball and two strikes to Brecker. The final line on Josh Sharman, who's the pitcher of record for UNLV right now, if the score were to hold. Sharman, in three innings, gave up five runs, four earned thanks to a first-inning error. He allowed five hits, walked a batter, didn't strike anybody out. He was efficient, though, in the third inning, going 1-2-3 on eight pitches, 47 pitches total for Sharman, as Acosta hits Brecker right square in the middle of the back. That was the slider that didn't slide as Brecker works his way on for the first time. So the leadoff man on in a one-run ball game. Taking a look here, if you're tuned into our video feed, yeah, right between the one and the nine on the back of Brecker, who's down to first. Brings up Brock Vredenburg, the first baseman who tripled down the left field line in his last at bat. It was the right field line, rather. He yanked it on a line drive just barely fair. Swings early, taps the first pitch straight down, called a foul ball emphatically and early by the home plate umpire John Cascato. Acosta played as a two-way player at El Camino Community College. Batted just 176 in 14 games a year ago. Pitched in eight games all out of the pen, including two saves out of the back of the bullpen. So he clips the outer third. Fastball running away from the left-handed batting Vredenburg is count quickly, nothing and two. Acosta pitching with the bats now backing the Rebel arms up. Hank Zeisler with the home run to lead off the third. Quick throw to first is not in time. And Volge then struck out looking following the Zeisler home run. Darian Williams singled. Bajani then popped out to right. And Jay Sharman ended the inning with a ground out back to the pitcher, Harrison Cook. Acosta's 0-2 pitch swung on, hit on the ground to the right side. Scooped up by Darian Williams. The underhand flip to the pitcher. Acosta covering at first. A good athletic play from the first year in the program player Acosta to hustle down to the first base bag. Brecker moves up to second. That'll be a 4-3 ground out on the scorecard for Vredenburg. Or 4-1, rather. Yeah, it was to the pitcher covering, a 4-1 ground out. Clark, the third baseman, grounded out to third back in the second, but drove in the only run in that frame. It was the last run for Michigan State, the most recent. Acosta dealing in a right-on-right matchup. Looking to second. Now to the plate. Cart checks the swing. Fastball called just downstairs. 4-2 win for UNLV in the opening game of the series. Thanks a lot in part to strong effort from Josh Ibarra in his first appearance in the Scarlet and Gray. One run on five hits over five frames and a win. Hayden Nierman earned the save in that first game as well. Ground ball chopped to the left side. Took a low hop as Alarcon was able to react. Low throw across the diamond is in time. No advancement from second for the catcher, Brecker. Flips the lineup back around to the top as Trent Farquhar works his way around to the left.
Farquhar.
Mentioned earlier, plenty of action going on around the Mountain West. Just now beginning, San Diego State taking on Cal in Scottsdale, Arizona. Part of the MLB 4 tournament going on. It's Grand Canyon and Nevada taking place right now in Phoenix as well. That game on ESPN Plus. Slider outside, just quite couldn't get it to cut back in as Farquhar, who's one of two so far, watched it for his ball. San Jose State hosting Omaha. It's Air Force on the road in Charleston, South Carolina, taking on the Richmond Spiders in a tournament. Nicely spotted fastball right down Broadway. Acosta gets even with Farquhar. And New Mexico taking on Oregon State once again. Oregon State, you remember, 2 days ago defeated the Lobos 21-1. Of course, Oregon State, one of the premier blue blood programs in college baseball. A bouncing ball stopped by Bajani. Good play by the catcher. Bajani, tough choice to make after last year. He was going to come back all the way, but it's interesting with a lot of the players that were affected by the extra COVID year kind of hanging around, taking that extra year of eligibility that was granted. Bajani, one of them. He receives this pitch from Acosta, just barely clipping the black on the outside of home plate for a called strike. Acosta coming in. After Nierman was removed with an injury before his first pitch. A check swing, yes he did, says the home plate umpire as Farquhar set down for the second time today. Acosta recovering well after hitting the first batter he faces. A couple of weakly tapped ground outs and a strikeout, how he retires the side in the fourth inning. Bottom of the lineup to lead us off in the bottom of the fourth in a 5-4 ball game. A tightly contested, high-scoring ball game to this point with UNLV trailing Michigan State 5-4 in the final game of a four-game series. UNLV, even after dropping the twin bill yesterday, still leads the all-time set against Michigan State 7-5 every game played here at Earl E. Wilson. Gianni Horvat to lead things off. First pitch from Harrison Cook bounces in. His fourth inning of work begins with his 51st pitch of the afternoon. So far for Cook, four runs all earned on five hits. Misses inside to Horvat. Cooks struck out three batters. He's walked two more. The Hank Zeisler home run, the most recent run batted in for the Rebels to lead off the third inning. Horvat reached on a fielder's choice in his only other plate appearance. Watches a bouncing ball inside. This accounts of three balls, no strikes. Horvat was brought around to score on the Diego Alarcon RBI hit in the second inning. Horvat officially 2 of 13 in the series. One of those hits, a three-bagger. Third baseman Kark, even with the bag and creeping, as Horvat, watching all the way on 3-0, takes a called strike right down Main Street. Horvat, Charles, and Alarcon, number 9, 1, and 2 in the lineup here for UNLV. Out of the full line, the 3-1 offering is shot foul. Push down the first base side from Horvat. Listed at 5'11", 166 pounds. A Valencia, California native is in from the right side. Here's the 3-2 pitch from Cook. Poked down the third base side, a chopper. Nice backhand grab by the third baseman Kark. Low throw picked out by Vredenberg at first for the out. What a play on both ends. Kark, who's shown off the glove already, not only today, but really throughout the entirety of this series. Especially on some of those backhand plays down the line. It's a long throw. It's a very tough throw to make. And Vredenberg helping him out at the end of it. With a nice pick with the left hand. Horvat drops to 0 for 2, although he has scored a run. Brings us to the top of the lineup for Ryland Charles, who's reached twice. 12-6 curveball. Tumbles through the top of the zone for a called strike. Charles walked to lead off the Rebels at bat in the first inning. Watched four pitches to earn his way to first and then drove in a run on a base hit in the second. Three-man shift on the right side of the infield. Watches as Cook misses outside. Cook had originally attended Kentucky, redshirted there, and then transferred to Iowa Western Community College. Charles rips this one through the right side of the infield, through the teeth of the shift. A big turnaround first base. He's forced to retreat back to first base swiftly, but Charles remains perfect. Two for two with a walk on the day. Charles records the sixth hit so far for the Rebels and represents the tying run. Diego Alarcon with a chance to move him over. One out and one on. Three-man shift on the left side of the infield now with the second baseman Farquhar flipping it around. Slider that stays inside is called for ball one. Alarcon one of two with the RBI single in the second. At Iowa Western, Cook was second-team all-conference. They went 50-10 last year. Quick throw back to first base. Charles back in head first and safely. Overall, 7-2 with a 3.6 earned run average last year. Coming off a strong season in the Northwoods League. Slider, or rather the curveball tumbling low, misses for a called ball two to Alarcon. Played for the Green Bay Booyah, formerly the Bullfrogs. Throw to first, bounced into Vredenberg. Looks like it slipped out of the hand of Cook. Vredenberg able to use that 6'7" frame and keep it in front by wearing it off the chest. Cook, originally from Iowa, comes set. Alarcon takes a hefty cut but can't connect on the pitch down but in the zone. That'll go as strike one. Coming out of high school, out of Cedar Rapids Prairie High School, Cook was rated as the number 188 overall pitcher in the country. He was a preseason All-American in his senior year as well. Throw goes to first, not in time. Charles back in head first and safely. Dad Brent went on to play for the Cardinals after playing football in college. Runner goes. Charles breaking on the pitch. That's called a ball. The throw bounced and he's called safe. Farquhar in disbelief at second base. He thought he had applied the tag, but the big bounce on the throw from the catcher Brecker allows Charles to swipe his second base in two tries on the year. Great job by Charles, who, if you remember back to Friday, his first stolen base of the year was on a similar play where the ball beat him to the bag, but in that one, he looked like Javi Baez and lifted the arm in a swim move. Was called safe. Now two for two. He was one of two all of last year, already eclipsing his total from a year ago. The 3-1 to Diego is called for ball four. A bouncing ball will put him on for the second time in three plate appearances. The game's tying run in scoring position for the number three batter in the lineup, Austin Krizik. Here comes the pitching coach, Mark Van Amee. There is action down the left field line. The bullpen is hot for Michigan State. And that's the manager, Jake Boss. It is a new arm coming into the game. Firing out of the bullpen is Andrew Carson, wearing number 17. We'll get to the partial line on Cook. You can't close the book on him with two runners on base charged to him if they were to score. We'll get you the name, or the numbers rather, on Carson when we return. Rebels threatening in the fourth, trailing by a run. 5-4 the score, with Andrew Carson sprinting nearly out of the bullpen to make his second appearance of the series. Carson coming in behind Harrison Cook, who's responsible for both runners on base as of now. Give you his partial line in a moment. It's Austin Krizek, first batter that Carson will face. Krizek 0-2. Watching the first pitch, a curveball that stays up and away but called for a strike in a right-on-right matchup. It's Ryland Charles on second, Diego Alarcon on first. They walked, or rather singled and walked in that order to get there. Cook lasted 3 1/3 innings. It took him 64 pitches to get there. Can't close the book on him yet. He's given up 4 runs all earned thus far. Runner breaks from second. A huge jump. The throw goes to second as Alarcon is thrown out. That'll be the second out of the inning. Wasn't quite a true double steal. Charles had an absolutely enormous break. He'll be given credit for the stolen base. Alarcon set down 2-4 on the put out at second. Yeah, Charles stole that one on the pitcher. Carson took a look, couple of hops. And that was a true double steal. Alarcon just didn't have as great of a break as you would need, all the attention being on Charles at third. Krizek swings and misses over a curveball, falling down and away from him. And the count goes to a ball and two strikes to the Rebel left fielder. Cook allowed 6 hits, struck out 3 and walked 3. Didn't go long enough to qualify for a win. Got to go 5 innings full, so the decision of going to the bullpen one way or the other for Michigan State. As Krizek leans away from a pitch, very nearly coming back over the inner third, but it's a called ball 2. Carson threw the final 3 innings of the opening game of the set. 3 scoreless frames, walked 2, gave up 1 hit, and struck out 3. Rebels weren't able to get anything going against the righty. Here's the 2-2. Krizek takes a called strike 3. He can't believe it. That one froze him at the knees, stranding a pair of runners on base. With that, we've played 4 innings. Rebels trailing 5-4. The 2, 3, and 4 batters due up for Michigan State when we come back to Earl E. Wilson Stadium. You're watching Rebel Baseball, brought to you by Parkway Tavern, official partner of UNLV Athletics and your official home of Rebels on the road. With over 250 beers, 24/7 gaming, and 5 Valley locations, there's no better place to watch the game than Parkway Tavern. Matt and Everett here from Earl E. Wilson Stadium. Top of the 5th inning is the second frame, pitched by Joey Acosta. Begins it with the first pitch fastball outside to Mitch Jebb, the shortstop batting in the number 2 hole for the Michigan State Spartans, led by their 14th-year boss, Jake Boss. Jeb is 0-1, reached on a fielder's choice in the second after walking in the first. Nicely spotted breaking ball moving over the outer half of the plate. It's called for strike 1 to even things up. Acosta came in after Hayden Nierman injured himself, apparently, on the last pitch that he threw before the top of the 4th inning. Bouncing ball blocked by Bajani, but with nobody on base, they'll let it go. Rebels threatened in the bottom of the inning after Gianni Horvat grounded out to third. Ryland Charles singled, stole second and third. Diego Alarcon walked. He was caught stealing on the double attempt with Charles before Krizek was called out on strike 3. The running fastball moving away is called for a ball. 3-1 Three balls and one strike to Jeb. Jeb, Walker, and Frank. First three batters due up against Acosta. Third baseman Alarcon even with the bag. Ball four outside on the heater as Acosta, who hit the first batter he faced, walks the first batter here in the fifth.
The right fielder, Zaid Walker.
One on, nobody out here in the top of the fifth inning, just shy of the halfway point of today's game. Zaid Walker in from the right. Right fielder wearing number three, one of two thus far on the afternoon. Acosta, the SoCal native, comes set. First pitch swinging is Walker. Drives one to center. Heading back is Charles. Into the gap he goes. Able to make the grab just shy of the warning track. A strong throw goes straight to second base and will keep Jeb at bay at first base. An aggressive approach by Walker results in the first out of the fifth inning.
Fielder, Jack Frank.
And Acosta looking to spin up a ground ball here. With one out and the runner on first base, double play active. Back up the middle. Frank got the scoring started with an RBI single in the first, and then took a great play by Hank Zeisler to retire him to lead off the third. Hank holding on at first. The throw goes in that direction. Back in head first and safely is Jeb. He stole four bases last year, two for three already on the season and attempts this season. Again, Alarcon even with the bag, but away from the line with a left-handed batter, watching Acosta fire to first. And again, back in safely is Jeb on the pickoff. Horvat at short is shallow and towards the bag. The opposite from Williams. Darien's away from the base and almost in the cut of the outfield. Runner goes. First pitch swinging and a high fly out of play off the bat by Jack Frank. The Rebels' next home game here at Earl E. Wilson Stadium, March 1st against Utah, former Mountain West battle. That'll be a one-off game on a Tuesday afternoon at 2:05. I'll be on the call with you before Cal Poly comes to town for a weekend set on Friday, March 4th through the 5th and 6th. Long look in from Acosta prior to the 0-1. Nicely spotted heater misses just outside. He's been going back to the well, throwing that same pitch in the same spot a number of times. John Cascato behind the plate's been calling it the same way. And one other note, following the game on the 6th on Sunday, there's a two-game series Monday, Tuesday, the 7th and 8th against Utah Valley. A bouncing ball blocked by Bajani. The defensive work from the backstop. This is a UNLV team with as high of expectations coming into a season as they've had in the last handful of years. Coaching staff uber excited about not only the returning players, they returned 6 out of 8 position players, as the throw to first is late, but the depth. They told me before the year that they have 15 fielders that they feel confident with going at any time, including 6 different outfielders that they feel comfortable throwing out there no matter what. Outfield's deep against Frank. The runner goes, pitches high. Horvat has to go behind his back for the throw that sneaks into center field as Jeb heading to third. The throw goes there, but it's late. It'll be a throwing error on Bajani. Stolen base E2 advancing for or counting for the advancement to third. The old saying goes is there's no outs on that side of the bag as a catcher. If you're missing to the third base side, it makes it so much tougher for the fielder on the bag to try to cross over all the middle infielders you'll find are right-handed and then try to return the glove to the bag and make the tag. 3-1 pitch from Acosta's way outside, but with first base open, not the worst miss. He does issue his second free pass of the inning, and there is action in the right field bullpen for UNLV. Brings in the left fielder Casey Mays, who's one of two on the afternoon thus far.
Left fielder Casey Mays.
Some preliminary warm-up tosses. The right-hander in the bullpen not even on top of the mound yet, so just getting going. And here comes Corey Vanderhook, the pitching coach, to give him some free time to warm up. as Acosta's gone an inning into third. Yet to allow a run, but he's walked three, or walked two rather, after Sharman walked just one. Again, the line on Josh Sharman was on the hook for the loss if the 5-4 score were to hold. Allowed all five runs, only four of them earned thanks to an error. Took him 47 pitches to get through three innings on five hits and a walk. He didn't strike out a batter, and he's not a big strikeout pitcher with just 26 punchouts last year and 55 and a third innings. Sharman's best inning was his last. So he went 1-2-3 in the third. And a quick meeting there broken up by John Cascato. Vanderhook out there to buy some time for the right-hander warming up. That brings in Mays. Singled, drove in a run in the first. Later came around to score. Right on left matchup with a runner on and one down. Two runners on, rather. That pitch misses away in the right on left matchup. Acosta at his third institution, attended Azusa Pacific University for his first 2 years of school, and then was at El Camino College for the next two as well. Working exclusively out of the stretch. This one's yanked but pulled well foul off the bat of Casey Mays. Entering into the day, 6 of 13 in the series, now 7 of 15. Batting average over four games just shy of 500. The next pitch for Acosta will be his 29th. He'll come set and do it on a 1-1 offering to the left-handed batting Casey Mays. Bounced in, Bajani able to keep it in front of him. One of the things that makes Eric Bajani such a stalwart defensively behind the plate is his ability to control the bounce. He's able to get the chest over the ball and not just stick it up straight into it. He's able to kind of bounce it where he wants to, keep it in front of the plate and not bouncing around possible advancement of the runners. Jeb on third, Frank on first. The 2-1 to Mays. Fought off the hands, poked into the seats down the third base side. Just past our camera, beyond the third base Michigan State dugout. Michigan State with five runs on just five hits. Four runs on six hits for UNLV, including Hank Zeisler's first home run in a scarlet and gray uniform. Count all square at two. Acosta sent. He deals. Swung on and missed. A major second out in a one-run ball game. May set down on strikes. It's the first putout. Make it the second, rather, for Acosta via the K. Brings up Peter On, the designated hitter this afternoon. Batting from the left, 0-for-2, does have an RBI. Drove in a run in the first inning on a tap out to second base. Acosta hoping to keep the Spartans off the board in the fifth inning. On started to offer up, but checks the swing, able to hold up. Acosta with action behind him in the pen. Likely throwing in his last frame, we'll see. Peter On, originally from Delafield, Wisconsin. Where's this one off the front elbow? He's got the elbow guard on. That doesn't muffle all the pain. It just takes away the initial shock. On earns his way down to first base.
Brian Brecker.
It's the second batter that Acosta's hit by a pitch. It was the first batter he faced in Brecker, who's due up right now for the second time against the reliever. Brecker 0-for-1 with the aforementioned base on balls, the Chicago native coming off of a redshirt season last year. Takes a slider just inside, called for a ball. Acosta tried to come in through the front door, but couldn't get it to break just enough. Sacks full, two down in a 5-4 ball game in the top of the fifth inning. Brecker takes down, called for ball two. Had two balls to no strikes. Brecker spent his summer with the Duluth Huskies in the Northwoods League. One of 18 Michigan State Spartans to play summer ball this year. Costa looks to second. Fires to first on the back pick. They got him. Zeisler applies the tag as Acosta gets out of dodge in the top of the fifth. With that, we've played half a ball game. The Rebels are as jacked up as they've been since we started. We'll be back with the bottom of the fifth. It's Zeisler to lead things off. You're listening to UNLV Rebels Baseball.
First baseman, Hank Zeisler.
Officially in the second half of today's action, bottom of the fifth inning from Earl E. Wilson, Matt Neverett welcoming you back into the final game of the opening series of the 2022 campaign. It'll be the middle third of the UNLV lineup up against Andrew Carson for Michigan State in his second inning of work out of the pen. He'll deal outside, beginning the right-on-left matchup with Zeisler with the called ball one. Hank went yard in his last time up. A mammoth blast beyond the right field fence for his first with UNLV. Takes another heater, another one away. Begins at two balls to no strikes. Joey Acosta getting out of dodge in the fifth. There were the bases loaded, two outs. Beautiful back pick play to pick Peter on off at first base. Zeisler was the one that applied the tag. He leans away from a fastball running in on him out of the hand of Carson. It's a called strike one. Still in a pretty good hitter's count is Hank. Only time he faced off against Carson on Friday, he worked a base on balls. It was one of two free passes issued by the right-hander. 2-1 pitch way up and out. The catcher Brecker had to spring up out of the squat and keep it in front of him. Zeisler, well ahead, three balls and one strike. He's been an excellent addition to this UNLV roster. Started all four games of the set at first. Takes a called ball four, a five-pitch walk to begin the fifth, and the tying run on base to get it started.
Thursday hitter, Cole Amavagi.
Cole Amavagi batting for the third time this afternoon. Walked in the second, struck out looking in the third. Harrison Cook, the starter, went 3 1/3. Final line is four runs all earned on six hits while walking three and striking out three. Breaking ball comes in through the front door to Andavolgi for a called strike. Cook, again, did not toss long enough to qualify for the win, so the decision either way going to the bullpen here for Michigan State. Sharman on the hook as of right now after three innings and five runs, four earned. Hammering 12-6 curveball goes straight down. A nice pitcher's pitch, if you will, for Andrew Carson. Carson Carson working out of the stretch. Zeisler with a very short lead off the bag at first. And DeVolge fights one off. Fists it straight back into the screen. Carson's originally from Rochester, Minnesota. Stayed close to home, at least by Michigan State standards, for JUCO ball. Played at East Lansing Community College for 2 years. And DeVolge watches high. First ball to two strikes in the at-bat. Carson, the son of former NHLer Jimmy Carson, played 10 years in the NHL. Played for the Kings, the Oilers, the Red Wings, the Canucks, and the Hartford Whalers. And DeVolge drives one to the gap in right center field. Turning around is the right fielder, Walker. This ball is gone, and the UNLV Rebels have their first lead of the day. Cole and DeVolge's first Rebel home run puts him on top in the bottom of the fifth inning. That one just kept carrying off the bat. For a young player like DeVolge, getting the shot here as the designated hitter in the final game of the opening series, stuck the bat head out, reached across home plate for it, and the Apo Taco yard ball puts the Rebels on top for the first time. You knew the bats were going to wake up. UNLV coming off of one of their best offensive seasons ever and returning many of the main cogs. It only took to the middle innings, and a Darian Williams wears a curveball on the first pitch he sees. So Carson, who was efficient in the fourth, walks a batter, gives up the long ball, and then hits a Darian Williams in the very next pitch. That'll bring out the catcher, Brian Brecker, and they'll call the entirety of the infield in before Eric Bajani steps in from the right. The right-hander quickly firing away in the bullpen for Michigan State down the left field line.
Catcher Eric Bajani.
And DeVolge in a crowded catcher's position has shown out here early. Got the start in game one yesterday of the doubleheader. It's the start here today as the DH and comes up big. He scored 2 of the 6 runs as well. Big swing and a miss for Bajani. He was trying to repeat his position mate's long ball, but no dice. Bajani's 0 for 2. One of just 2 Rebels to not reach base thus far already. With Austin Krizik the other one, he's 0 for 3. Bajani hits it off the end of the bat. A swinging bunt down the third base side. Scooped up by the pitcher, Carson. No play anywhere. An infield hit for Bajani keeps the inning going. First 4 batters have reached in order. Darian Williams to second. Bajani with his first hit. That's the reverse broadcaster, Jinx. I'll take credit for that. 2 on, still no outs, and 2 runs across already in the frame. With Jay Sharman standing in, his brother Josh now off the hook. Sharman was on the line for the loss, but now a no decision. Either way for the starting pitchers. Cook and Sharman will leave with NDs. As Jason Sharman squares to bunt, pulls it back. The left-hander watches a called ball, 1 outside. He singled and scored back in the second inning. Drove in the game's first run for UNLV. That scored DeVolge from second. Sharman also ripped one on the ground back to the pitcher. And a 1-3 put out to end the run scoring third. Williams bouncing around off second. Here's the 1-0. Another bunt attempt, another pulled back bunt. That misses low for a called ball 2. So Sharman, with runners on first and second, seeing the defense, pulling it back. Kark, the third baseman, he's been a statue. He's not going anywhere. That's what you want out of your third baseman in this situation. Runners on first and second with no outs. A lot of teams, this is a automatic bunt situation. As Sharman gets one down, but it's foul, straight behind home plate. And this is a situation that is practiced on both sides at nauseam. This is something that these players have had drilled into their memories from early on. It's the shortstop Jeb giving the series of signs. Typically, it's either the third baseman or the catcher. Jeb's near the bag. to the first baseman, Vredenberg, creeping. Jason squares to bunt, pulls it back, a high and outside fastball, called for ball three. He's worked himself into a hitter's count here. Three balls and a strike for Sharman. Waiting on deck is Horvat. It's a big leadoff of first for Bajani as Williams is checked near the bag at second. He's just a couple of steps away. Sharman doesn't square to bunt. Instead watches a called ball four as it sneaks past the catcher Brecker. Just a 90-foot advancement all the way around. Bases loaded, still no outs. The first five batters have reached in order. Now it looks like it could be the end of the line as they'll make the move to the bullpen. It's the pitching coach, Mark Vandermeet, out. He made the call immediately. So the Rebels' bats had woken up earlier, doing a great job here in the fifth of just getting on base. That's the first step in tacking on these crooked numbers. We'll get to the partial line on Carson, the name and numbers on the new pitcher, and the finale of the fifth when we return the Rebels on top and threatening with the bases loaded and no outs. Don't go anywhere. This is UNLV Baseball. Wearing number 30, it's the 6'2" right-hander Kyle Dunning. Coming in, trying to put out the fire for Michigan State here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Still no outs. Two runs already across on the frame on the Cole and Volge two-run homer. Andrew Carson done after two-thirds of an inning, did not record an out here in the fifth. Bases full, no outs. Here's the number 9 batter, Gianni Horvat. Horvat is 0-2, but reached and scored on a fielder's choice back in the second inning. Right-on-right matchup is Dunning deals. Nicely spotted heater, watched all the way for a strike by Horvat. It's Sharman on first, Bajani on second, Adarian Williams on third base. Following the end of Volge home run, Adarian Williams was hit by the first pitch. Bajani singled on a swinging bunt, and then Sharman walked. Looping curveball in for a strike through the front door. As Dunning ahead of Horvat 0-2. Dunning, a transfer from Tacoma Community College, where he played 2 years, 3-1 record last year. Right-hander working out of the stretch. Horvat, good batting eye there from the freshman as he watches a curveball that stays low. Defensively, Dylan Kark at third, even with the bag and creeping. Same deal with Vredenburg. He'll hold on at first base. Middle infield's double play depth. They'll trade two outs for the run with UNLV leading 6-5. 1-2 fastball called for strike three. Horvat knew it right away. So Dunning gets a huge first out with the double play active anywhere in the infield in the fifth inning. Brings up the seventh batter of the frame, the top of the lineup in Ryland Charles.
Center fielder, Ryland Charles.
This is the guy you want up if you're Stan Stilte and the coaching staff. Charles is having a perfect afternoon thus far. Two hits, two stolen bases, an RBI, and a walk. He's been the MVP of the opening series for the Rebels thus far as he takes high, calling for ball one. 8 of 16, a perfect 50-50 split for Charles. Home run, three doubles, and five base hits. The 1-0. Running in on the hands, called for a strike. Good movement on that fastball from Dunning. The partial line on Carson. Two runs both earned on 26 pitches. All the runners would be charged to Carson if they score. Ryland Charles takes inside. Two balls and a strike. Now the count. Two-thirds of an inning for Carson. Two runs on two hits with two walks. He struck out one batter. It was Krizik to end the fourth. It was the first batter he faced. Here's the pitch out of the stretch. Charles swings. Line drive off the glove of the shortstop, Jeb. Everybody had frozen, so the putout's going to be at second, but Darian Williams is going to score from third. Charles ripped it at the shortstop, who had to go off of his glove. An absolute screamer as the putout was at second base. Sharman retired. 6-4 on the putout. Williams scores to make the lead 7-5, however. Charles will be given credit for a fielder's choice. That brings up Diego Alarcon with two down and three runs across in the inning. Watches a first pitch fastball.
The third baseman, Diego Alarcon.
The fielder's choice for Charles. Short lead off of first base with a three-man shift on the left side of the infield. Plenty of room if Diego's able to go the other way. Steady drives it straight away to center field. Heading over towards right is Jack Frank as the center fielder makes the grab, but not before the Rebels take the lead for the first time and get the insurance run as well. Cole Andevolge goes yard to go up, and Ryland Charles puts a ball in play to score Darian Williams. After five innings of play, the Rebels have their first lead on top of Michigan State 7-5. This is Rebel Baseball. UNLV baseball is back no matter where you're watching this season. Be sure to buy a cold, crisp Dos Equis and yell, "Go Rebels!" Enjoy Dos Equis responsibly, imported by Cervezas Mexicanas. UNLV with their first lead as we enter into the top of the sixth. It's Peyton Fuller to toe the slab. First pitch swinging is Brian Brecker, the Michigan State catcher, and welcoming Fuller to the game with a rip right back up the middle as Brecker reaches for the second time. Fuller in behind Joey Acosta, who did a great job of coming in, calming things down. Acosta allowed no base hits. Acosta didn't give up a hit. He walked two and hit two, but didn't allow a hit or a run.
Breitenberg.
Acosta finishing with two walks and two strikeouts as Breitenberg takes the first pitch for a called ball. So Acosta lifted after two innings. It's Peyton Fuller, the right-hander. Fuller, the transfer from Oregon, using his extra year due to COVID-19 year for everybody else, is the fastball missing outside. Acosta again, final line, two innings, no hits, no runs. He walked two and hit two, though, while striking out a pair on 36 pitches. He's on the hook right now, the pitcher of record, with UNLV taking over the lead. This one's knocked straight back by Breitenberg, who tripled in the second inning. Fuller, the righty out of Ashland, Oregon, graduated and using the extra year, wearing number 40 here in his first appearance for UNLV. Quick throw to first base is late. Brecker back in safely. Long and lanky, the 6'4" Peyton Fuller, standing at 190 pounds. A four-year player, two-year starter for the Ducks in the Pac-12. Left-handed batting, Breitenberg goes down to a knee as he hacks over the breaking ball. Count evens up at two balls and two strikes. Fuller finished his career at Oregon 3-1 in 47 outings, a 4.52 ERA in Pac-12 outings. Here's his 2-2 to Breitenberg. Taken for a called strike three. Beautiful changeup moving away from the left-handed batter for the first out of the sixth inning.
Third baseman, Dylan Kark.
One out, one on. Here's Dylan Kark. Right-handed batter at the bottom of the lineup. Out of the stretch, Fuller fires. Fuller in for his first inning of work. Has looked efficient thus far, firing to first base. Not in time. Kark has grounded out twice, both to Alarcon at third. Diego backing up with a 1-0 pitch upcoming, currently behind the bag. Swung on and missed. That fastball upstairs fooled him. Peyton Fuller went back and forth between the bullpen and the rotation in his 4 years at Oregon. He made seven starts, but he exclusively started his last 2 years. Of course, the 2020 season, a weird one. It was canceled in mid-March due to the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic. A running fastball moves away from the right-handed batting Kark. Call for ball two. Fuller has his bachelor's degree in applied economics. Here in his first year with the Rebels, his only year remaining of eligibility. Runner goes, pitch outside. Bajani's throw to no one in particular at second base. Both Horvat and Adarian Williams froze, and with a right-handed batter up, typically it's the second baseman. You can go back and forth depending on how you communicate. But Brecker, given credit for the stolen base, it's his first of the campaign. Kark now batting with the runner in scoring position. He's ahead, three balls and a strike as well. Williams checking him at second. Hank now back behind the bag at first. The 3-1 from Fuller. Swung on, popped up left side. Playable as the left fielder Krizik comes in. Calls off the shortstop Horvat as Krizik makes the catch for the second out of the sixth inning. Back to second, meanwhile, is Brecker. Fuller squaring off against now the top of the lineup with Trent Farquhar matriculating his way to the box.
Center fielder, Trent.
Runner on second
Farquhar.
With two down. In a 7-5 ball game, 7 runs on 8 hits for UNLV. Farquhar has one of the 6 Michigan State hits, came on a base hit in the second inning. He struck out in the fourth against Joey Acosta, one of the 2 punch-outs for the right-hander. Right-hander Fuller fires. Swung on, line to center, charging is Charles. It drops in front of him with a ton of topspin. It sneaks past him. The run's going to score easily as Farquhar slows up, content with an RBI double. Charles took a step back off the bat, and that ended up being what burned him. As that thing tumbled, caught some huge topspin and bounced in front, and a tough play for Charles, who's been playing in right field. He does play a very capable center field, but making his first appearance of the year, didn't quite see it necessarily off the bat. An RBI two-bagger for Farquhar makes it a one-run game, 7-6, with UNLV still on top. For Farquhar, it's his 6th hit in 17 at-bats in the set. Mitch Jeb batting from the left side. The shortstop due up with 2 down. First pitch swinging. Ground ball off the glove of the first baseman, Zeisler. He puts it in the back pocket on what should be ruled an infield hit for Jeb. It took an extraordinary effort for Zeisler to take a dive to his right. He was able to get a glove on it, but by the time he recovered, no chance for Fuller to get there, so the advancement to third for Farquhar comes on Jeb's first hit of the afternoon. That'll bring out the pitching coach, Corey Vanderhook. With no action in the right field bullpen, this is strictly a visit to calm down Peyton Fuller with the game's tying run on third and the go-ahead run on first base. Vanderhook, as well as the entirety of the infield out there, it's likely a strategic decision to decide how they're going to attack Zaid Walker. Walker, the right fielder, 1 of 3 today. Homered yesterday, 4 of 15 in the series, but he is the top returning batter. This Michigan State team. Slowly working his way out there is John Cascato, the home plate umpire. It was a big day yesterday on campus, with both the men's and women's basketball teams dominating their opponents. For the women's team, the Lady Rebels, it was a 31-point win over San Jose State. The first end of a doubleheader as the running Rebels dominated the 21-3 Colorado State Rams. They now have 4 losses on the year. UNLV swept the season series with 2 out of their 4 defeats. 2 down, runners on the corners. First pitch, curveball stays up. Fuller, nice, sharp, snapping breaking ball, but just a bit too high for Walker, who was watching all the way here in the right-on-right matchup. Pressure situation here in the top of the 6th inning. Walker swings through the fastball. Man, he was trying to drive that one back to East Lansing. Pulled the head way early on that high heater from Fuller, and the count even at 1. Walker singled and scored in the first. Grounded out sharply to third in the second. Skied out to center in the 5th. Curveball up and in. It hits him. Got him on the front left arm, and that'll load the bases with 2 outs. Nobody up in the bullpen. Fuller in his first inning and his first appearance. Former starter likely able to stretch it out. Jeb to second. Farquhar stays at third as Zaid Walker hit by a pitch. It's the 3rd hit batsman in this Michigan State roster today. It was Acosta hitting the other 2. Brings up Jack Frank with the sacks full in a 1-run ball game. Doesn't get any better than this on a Sunday afternoon. Fuller misses up and away. Frank 1 of 2 with a walk so far here in the final game of the series. Long look in for Fuller. A deep breath before the 1-0. Breaking ball just outside. Announced attendance of 797 getting into it here on a $2 ticket Sunday. Get your tickets for future games at unlvtickets.com. Fuller's offering. down low, called for a strike. 2-1 the count as Fuller needing just that one pitch to get out of it. Missed some time last year with an arm injury. Made just three starts in his final year at Oregon. Pitching out of the pen for the Rebels. 2-1, swung on and missed. Nice fading changeup with the arm side run moving away from the left-handed batter, Frank. One run across on two hits so far in the inning. Fuller hoping to limit it to just that. Everybody in the infield deep. The shortstop, Horvat, a step towards the middle. Everybody in the outfield shifted to the left with the exception of Krizik. Here's the 2-2. Swung on and missed. Peyton Fuller able to strand the bases loaded and keep UNLV with the lead. 7-6 heading into the bottom of the sixth. The heart of the UNLV lineup due up when we return. This is UNLV Baseball. We've got a fun one on our hands here on a Sunday afternoon. Matt and Everett welcoming you back to Earl E. Wilson Stadium. Thank you for tuning in, however you may be watching. You got plenty of options now with the new UNLV Athletics app. It did a great job of redesigning the UNLV app. You can watch the stream of any live event, including baseball, softball, basketball, anything. The UNLV streams also on the UNLV Athletics YouTube page. Austin Krizik batting against Kyle Dunning, beginning his second inning of work by snapping in a curveball for a strike. Rebels leading 7-6, Michigan State fighting back in the sixth inning. RBI double from Trent Farquhar drove in Brian Brecker, one of three hits allowed in the inning by Peyton Fuller, but was able to strand the bases loaded with a strikeout of Jack Frank to limit the damage to one as Krizik swings through a breaking ball for strike two. Krizik, the only Rebel to not reach base today, 0-3. Some would say he's due. The 0-2 pitch. Good job of fighting it off by Krizik, who pops it up into the seats. That was a spinner in on the hands from Dunning, who in his inning, just under an inning rather, of work, has not been afraid to break that pitch off. Fastball misses up and in, or up and away rather, as Krizik watching all the way on nothing and two. Joey Acosta went two innings. No runs on no hits, but did walk two and hit two batsmen. 1-2, swung on and missed by Krizik. Dunning's got that curveball working, and he fools Krizik. Strikes out for the third time here in the contest. Bottom sixth, one out in a one-run ball game.
First baseman.
That'll bring up Hank Zeisler, who's having a great start to the year. 4 of 14, including his first Rebel home run. Deep blast to right field to lead off the third inning. All bouncing down and in, very nearly hitting the back foot of Hank Zeisler. He's pointing to the back foot saying that it hit him. Umpire John Cascato didn't call it right away, and it's tough to ask for an appeal. As Zeisler takes high, here's the replay. See, the issue is that Zeisler was pointing at his back foot, but that one bounced closer to the front foot. Got Oscar season coming up. Zeisler will not be winning one. The 2-0. Nicely spotted changeup by Dunning is in for a strike high in the zone. That's a bold pitch on 2-0. To go up in the zone with a hanging changeup like that, Zeisler watching all the way on a called strike. He's done nothing if not work counts. He's walked three times in the first four games. Takes inside here, called for ball three. Zeisler, the only Rebel with three walks so far. Definitely a calm and detailed approach. Nice spinning breaking ball comes in through the back door from Dunning. Zeisler was more concerned about walking down to first. He was ready to go. That late last second break on the breaking pitch brings the count full. Three balls, two strikes, one out, nobody on. In the bottom of the sixth inning, final game of the set. Four-gamer to get things going. 3-2 payoff pitch, down low, called for ball four. What an at-bat by Hank Zeisler, earns his second walk in two plate appearances. It's his fourth of the year to lead the ball club. He'll look down to Kevin Higgins on the third base side, as well as the batter Cole Andovolgi. In a one-run ball game, getting into the later stages of the game, every quick little decision can make a big difference, even from the coaching staff. Andovolgi went yard in his last time up. Went the opposite way to right. Backs the head away from a high and inside here. Andovolgi and Zeisler both clubbing their first Rebel home runs today. Andovolgi's one of two officially, also walked and struck out back in the third inning. Dunning fires the curveball, drops in for a strike. Especially in college ball, you'll see these pitchers with a big breaking ball like that. They'll only throw it in certain spots to certain batters. Not Dunning, he's firing that curveball to everyone and every count already. Sends Zeisler scrambling back to the bag at first. Standing in safely is the Rebel first baseman. The ball and a strike to Andovolgi. Here's the pitch. Outside, called for ball two. Andovolgi, spelled A-N-D-A-V-O-L-G-Y-I. Transfer from Golden West Community College. Los Angeles native, yet another SoCal member of this UNLV roster. Another throw to first, gets by Vredenburg. Zeisler, rounding second. He's going to try for third. The throw from Farquhar is in time. Zeisler sliding in. He is tagged out. That one took a huge bounce off the fence and came right to the second baseman, Trent Farquhar. It'll be an error on Fuller for the advancement from first to second. And then a 4-5 put out at third for Zeisler. So all of a sudden, two up and two away in the sixth. And a 2-1 count to Cole Andovolgi, batting now with nobody on. Breaking ball started at the front shoulder, missed just inside. Call for ball three. Waiting on deck is Edarian Williams. And Volgi takes down low. Back-to-back free passes after ball four was called. Second walk of the game for Andovolgi. That's what you want out of the middle part of that lineup. Zeisler and Andovolgi having very similar games, both with two walks, I should say, and a home run. They've seen a lot of pitches. They've driven the ball well, and they've got the only two long balls for UNLV today. Andovolgi to first. Edarian Williams standing in from the right, one of two, hit by a pitch in the last time up. Takes the curve ball down and outside, called for a ball. Dunning coming in after Andrew Carson was tabbed with two runs in just two-thirds of an inning. Didn't record an out in the fifth and allowed five straight batters to reach. Williams had to clear the front hip, and the head went with it. He pulled it well early and misses on the off-speed pitch inside. Count a ball and a strike to Edarian. One of three today. He was one of ten entering the contest. Another breaking ball, another called strike. Dunning snapping that pitch off over and over again. Some movement in the left field bullpen, but nobody throwing as of yet. Rebels bullpen is quiet after Peyton Fuller was able to get through the sixth. Williams rips one down the left field line, but hooking foul into the aforementioned Michigan State bullpen. E got that one off the end of the bat. Reading curveball all the way. Back to first is Andovolgi with two down. Seven runs on eight hits for the Rebels. Six on eight for the Spartans. Williams watches up. Fastball way high and out. All square at two now. Two balls, two strikes, two outs here in the home half of the sixth inning. To number two, Adarian Williams. Left side of the infield especially deep. Farquhar at second. Shaded near the bag up the middle. Williams fights off a pitch and shoots it straight back to the screen. Able to see another one out of the hand of Kyle Dunning. With Freidenberg holding on at first, plenty of room on the right side of the infield should Adarian get a pitch on the outside and be able to poke it that way. A number of the Rebels' seven runs have come via the seeing eye single like that. The pitch. Williams can't connect, swings and misses at the breaking ball. Turns into a four-batter inning. And with that, we've played six. It's the Rebels leading Michigan State 7-6, top of the seventh, when we return to Earl E. Wilson Stadium. This is Rebel Baseball, brought to you by Finley Chevrolet, located in the southwest of Vegas at 215 and South Rainbow. It's Nevada's number one Chevrolet volume dealership. Frankly, they're customer-driven. Back at Earl E. Wilson Stadium for the top half of the seventh inning. We've got the tightest of games, a 7-6 lead for UNLV, hoping to hold on and split the opening four-game series to begin the 2022 season. Mays on Brecker. Numbers 5, 6, and 7 batters in the lineup for Michigan State. Second inning of work for Peyton Fuller. Former Oregon Duck begins with a bunt. Right back to him. He's off the mound. Slips. Falls. Zeisler's off the bag. Called safe at first is Casey Mays. And the game's tying run reaches on a bunt single up the middle.
Designated hitter.
Tough Peter play for Fuller, who was in no man's land. And laid around on the bunt attempts was Mays. He's able to beat it down the line with some good hustle. And again, the tying run reaching with Peter on due up. Left-handed batter. Hitless today, but was hit by a pitch back in the fifth inning. Fuller misses up and away. Alarcon, the third baseman, creeping heavily just in case. Middle infield double play depth with Williams now shading away from the bag at second. Zeisler holding on at first. Williams covering some ground there to fill the gap on the right side. Horvat's the one shaded up the middle more so. 1-0 pitch knocked straight back our way. Big shout out to those watching, listening, wherever you're ingesting the ball game on our YouTube stream. Former Rebel pitcher Bradley Spooner was tuned in last night. Much appreciated. 7-6 the score here today. The Rebel Bats waking up a little bit more here on a Sunday. No Sunday scaries for the Rebs today. A bunt goes straight back and hits Eric Bajani on the... Can't catch up to the pitch in the dirt. First down to the top of the seventh inning. Pre-stretch break sets up a double play ball up the middle.
The catcher, Brian
Fuller, a ground ball pitcher for sure. Brings up Ryan Brecker, who's one of two. He was also hit by a pitch. Joey Acosta hit both on and Brecker over his two innings of work. Although Acosta is the pitcher of record right now for the Rebels. A bunt pushed down the third base side. That'll go foul off the bat of Brecker. Fuller dropped the arm angle heavily there. That one was nearly a sidearm fire. It looked like it was coming from left field. You see that a lot with Chris Sale the other way at the major league level. With just the way that the arm angle comes in, it's extremely hard to pick it up when you fire it from that low and that wide coming across the plate. Quick throw goes to first base. Back in head first and safely is Mays. Brecker singled and stole second. Later came around to score in his last at-bat in the sixth. Working out of the stretch is Fuller. The former Oregon Duck deals. The 0-1 pitch is popped straight back. Brecker quickly behind, nothing and two. Speaking with the coaching staff pregame today, just about how they felt about the four-game series to start the year, and they were not huge fans, but after last year, schedule-wise, this is nothing. Interesting schedule last year. We're back to a more quote-unquote normal schedule this year. Swung on and missed. Strike three is Brecker. Blown by on the fastball. Back-to-back strikeouts for Peyton Fuller after giving up the leadoff single. One pitch away from getting out of dodge here in the seventh.
Brock Vredenberg.
Standing in his way, though, is the 6'7" first baseman Brock Vredenberg. Big-bodied left-handed hitter is one of three today. Runner on first is Mays. They'll take a look over there. Quick snap throw, not in time. One final from Mountain West opponents as Air Force was blanked by Richmond 2-0. Mentioned earlier that Fresno State drubbed UC Riverside 17-2 at home earlier this morning. First pitch to Vredenberg. Taken outside, called for a ball. The Wolfpack of Nevada in action against Grand Canyon. San Jose State hosting Omaha as well. Left side of the infield's deep as Vredenberg swings and misses at a pitch, diving underneath the bat. Just barely tipping it back into the mid of Bajani. Fuller recorded two strikeouts in the sixth. He froze Vredenberg on a called strike three and then fanned Jack Frank with the bases full to end the inning. Count even at one, Fuller fires. Vredenberg hits it straight back. That'll clear the seats here at Earl E. Wilson. And Fuller ahead, a ball and two strikes. Nobody up in the pen behind him. Michigan State with action in their pen down the left field line. Right-hander looks loose and ready to go, standing atop the mound with his hand on his hip. 30-second pitch up coming from Fuller. Here it is on 1-2. It'll wait. Quick throw to first base. Sends the runner Mays back in head first and safely. Mays has stolen one base already in the series and representing the tying run, they're keeping a close eye on him. Fuller takes the sign from Bajani. Sets up outside. Here's the 30-second pitch from Peyton Fuller. Again, a throw to first base. More so just to let Mays know that he's not forgetting about him with a big pitch upcoming on 1-2. Second baseman Williams is in the cut of the outfield, grass shaded especially deep with two down. Horvat, the shortstop, shaded near the middle. Now the 1-2. Runner goes. Pitch is high and outside. Throw down from Bajani on a line. Safe. The tag applied to the upper body of Mays, who had a great jump. Oftentimes, if the tag is that high up, you're going to be called safe by default. It was a great pitch to throw on for Bajani. Yeah, Mays with a feet-first slide in there safely underneath the tag. Two steals and two tries. The count 2-2 with two down. Fuller's firing. Ground ball right to Horvat, who goes down to a knee, grabs it on a hop. The throw to first base is in time. A big-time pressure play from Gianni Horvat gets us to the seventh inning stretch with the UNLV Rebels coming to bat, leading by a 7-6 score. Eric Bajani to lead things off when we return. This is a fun one here on Rebel Baseball.
Get out of your seats and on your feet. Let's stretch them out here.
Coming out of the seventh inning stretch, the bottom third of the lineup due up for the Rebels, leading by a 7-6 score. An insurance run is going to be imperative with Michigan State threatening in nearly every inning. They've gone down in order exactly once. It's going to be a dogfight to the end here on a Sunday afternoon as Eric Bajani takes a called strike. Third inning of work for Dunning begins the way that he's done it all day, just spinning curveball after curveball in there, sneaking in a fastball every now and then. Fires the heater here that Bajani taps straight back. The Rebel backstop behind, no balls and two strikes in his fourth plate appearance. He's one of three overall. Grounded out to third in the second. Popped out to right in the third. Singled in the fifth, only time he's been on. Three-man shift on the left side of the infield against him as he takes high. Rebels with seven runs on eight hits, six on nine for Michigan State. Bajani followed by Jason Sharman, who's awaiting on deck, and Gianni Horvat in the hole, who made an excellent stab at short to end the top of the seventh. Bajani pops it up right side of the infield, playable for Vredenberg. First baseman, barely in fair ground, makes the catch on the cut of the infield grass as Bajani retired on the infield pop-up to begin the seventh inning.
Right fielder, Jason Sharman.
There is motion in both bullpens. Michigan State with a right-hander up and tossing. Sharman digs into the box. Nobody throwing in the UNLV bullpen as of now. Fuller back and forth between the pen and the rotation at Oregon. Definitely can go multiple innings as Sharman bunts one on a hop into the third base dugout for a foul ball. Sharman's one of two, singled and scored after driving in a run in the second. Grounded out back to the mound in the third and walked back in the fifth. It's number 35, Kyle Bischoff, getting loose for the Michigan State Spartans. 35, Bischoff warming up. That pitch misses inside to Sharman. Dunning, so far through two and a third, has not given up a hit or a run, but he's walked two. He struck out three of the eight batters he's faced. Sharman fights this pitch off the hands and shoots it into the seats down the left field line. Rebel right fielder today, behind a ball and two strikes. Sharman making his first start of the year with Rylan Charles sliding to center. James Gamble not in the lineup today. Again, the coaching staff comfortable with what they told me, six different outfielders at any time. Sharman puts a charge into this one, deep to left. Mays going back, turning around, making the catch on a full back pedal. That one had some serious side spin as Mays was running towards the gap, turned, and again made that catch looking like a safety, directly backwards as he reached up to make the catch. That one covered plenty of ground, but didn't drop. It's the second out of the seventh inning. Gianni Horvat, the number nine batter in. First pitch swing, tapper off the end of the bat, scooped up by the pitcher fielder. The underhand flip to first is going to wipe out the side. Coming out of the seventh inning stretch in three batters in a quick and easy fashion. And with that, we've played seven innings. The Rebels leading Michigan State by 7-6 score, getting into crunch time late. The bottom of the Michigan State lineup to lead things off when we return to Earl E. Wilson Stadium. The right-hander Peyton Fuller back out for a third inning of work atop the mound in relief for UNLV. He's been excellent so far, giving up just one run. It's a one-run ball game, 7-6, UNLV on top over the Michigan State Spartans. Dylan Kark, the number nine batter, to lead things off. So far for Fuller, two innings, a run on four hits, but he has registered four strikeouts, including two in the seventh. He'll deal out of the full windup to begin the inning as Kark takes a hard fastball, breaking in over the outer half for a called strike. Kark is 0-3 so far, has grounded out twice to Alarcon at third, including an RBI ground out in the second. Popped out to left against Fuller in the sixth. 12-6 curveball breaking down and away, called for a ball to even up the count. In the bottom of the seventh, the Rebels down in order. As Eric Bajani popped out to first, Sharman flied out deep to left, and then Horvat tapped down off the end of the bat straight back to the mound. A check swing. Yes, he did, says the home plate umpire John Cascato. Likely would have been a strike anyway. I think that's what batter Kark is asking. Was that in the zone or was that a check swing? It was a point to the batter from the umpire. Lead you to believe it was a check swing. 1-2 pitch. Call for a ball. The umpire froze for dramatic effect before calling it for ball two. And now Bajani turning around and likely that conversation. Hey, how far off the plate was that? One was very close, tough one to watch with two strikes. Here we go again. Fuller deals. 2-2 pitch. Lambasted. Crushed to left. Krizik at the wall. He's going to turn around and watch it go, and this game is tied at 7. That one was sky high. Came down just a couple of feet over the fence and left. Thought that off the bat, that thing was going to clear the fence by a mile. A good piece of hitting with two strikes by Kark. And we're knotted up at 7. We're right back where we began. Second extra base hit allowed out of 5 by Fuller. And that'll wipe out a possible win for Joey Acosta. He'll leave with a no decision as Fuller deals to the leadoff man Trent Farquhar. First pitch swinging. He deposits one into right center field that drops for a base hit. The homer to left, followed by this single to right. And all of a sudden, Michigan State with the go-ahead run on here in the top half of the eighth inning. Action in the bullpen. It's the southpaw getting loose for the Rebels. And here comes Corey Vanderhook to buy him some more time. Farquhar reaches on his third hit of the game, two singles and a double. Mitch Jeb, the next batter, awaiting. See if we can get a glimpse of who that is warming up. Looks like Nick Rupp. Got the red glove on the right hand. He tossed, of course, in the first game. He was the first man out of the pen for UNLV of the year. So Vanderhook on the mound now that the game is tied and the go-ahead run is on. Everybody in the infield joining as well. This is a long one as Vanderhoek now talking to the umpire. That's going to be another mound visit used up as Cascada walks in tow with Corey Vanderhoek down the first base side, and he's been tossed. Corey Vanderhoek tossed from the game. Not quite sure what was said, but I think he tossed him on the mound. I saw Cascada make a motion. I was thinking it couldn't have been an ejection, and now here's Stan Stolte. Trying to put the lip reader hat on here. They're facing away from us in the press box, so hard to tell, but it's a quick talk as Stolte now heading back to the dugout. So that was a weird instance. Resulting in the first ejection of the year. It's Vanderhoek. The pitching coach makes his way down to the right field clubhouse. Have to get some clarification on that one after the game. It seemed like an innocuous mound visit. At the very least, he did buy time for the reliever to warm up. After all that, here's Mitch Jeb. Not been retired yet today, although he only has one hit. A base, rather a single in the sixth off of Fuller. First pitch swinging, a roller tap foul on the first base side. Jeb had walked twice, scored once, also reached on a fielder's choice to go along with his single. Scored one of two at home. The lefty looks loose in the bullpen beyond the right field fence. Alarcon, the third baseman, creeping, guarding against the bunt with no outs and a run already home in the inning. Runner stays. Bunt attempt pulled back by Jeb. Call for ball one to even the count. Both sides with seven runs, but Michigan State's done it on 11 hits, spreading out the singles. It's Rupp warming up down the right field line. Nick Rupp, the next man up. 1-1 fastball inside, diving to stop it was Bajani. A full-fledged backhand dive to keep that one from going to the backstop. Nice play by the catcher. This is a plucky Michigan State team. A lot of young players, but a lot of balls put in play. They do not strike out much. Fuller, a strikeout artist. This one slapped to left field, fading towards the line, a foul ball. Austin Krizik gave it a run into the corner, but instead that thing off the bat of the left-handed hitter spinning towards the seats and drops harmlessly for strike two. Evens up the count of 2 balls and 2 strikes. Waiting on deck is Zaid Walker. Dylan Kark homered to left to begin the inning. And Farquhar singled to right center on the next pitch. Fuller laboring here in the eighth. Coming up is his 44th pitch. It'll come on 2-2. Here it is. Just high. Pitch with some arm side run moving away from the batter Jeb. And the count goes full, 3-2 with no outs. Might not expect to see the runner Farquhar go off at first, but would not be unheralded. Jeb, one of the top returners for Michigan State, was on the Big Ten all-freshman team a year ago. The payoff offering. Fuller's pitch. Swung on, slapped to left once again, fading towards the corner once again. This ball lands foul once again. That was nearly the same look. That one had a bit more pop on it. Maybe 10 extra feet, but with the same result. And Farquhar running across the diamond to get back to first base. You're killing me, Smalls. Jeb's going to take his time going back to the plate, as he was already halfway to second base when that one landed. We'll try to break up the timing of Fuller. Been a long at bat. This has been a battle. Again, the later you get into the ball game, the more pressure filled every situation, every pitch gets. Zeisler holding on at first, middle infield pinch and a double play depth. Alarcon even off the bag at third. After the foul ball, here we go again, the 3-2 pitch. Swung on, roll to the right side of the infield. Second baseman Williams to his left. He'll glove it and fire to first in time. A 90-foot advancement to Farquhar at second. Jeb retired for the first time today. That was the only play for Adarian Williams. A two-strike swing if there ever was one for Jeb. He's got great speed, and Williams knew it, so he turned and fired quickly to first base.
Right fielder.
First out of the eighth comes on the Jeb tap-out. He does move the runner up to scoring position, bringing up Zaid Walker, right-handed batting right fielder. He's one of three on the game, singled in the first and scored. Since then, hitless. He did reach when he was hit by a pitch in the sixth by Joey Acosta. Williams keeping an eye on the bag with one down here in the top of the eighth inning. Fuller out of the stretch. Walker lines one over the head of Williams into right center field. That'll score the run. Michigan State back on top. Walker heading to second. The throw goes through the cutoff. Down the line, Horvat can't field it. Michigan State reclaims the lead on an RBI double from Zaid Walker. It's the second run of the inning across, and before Fuller can even catch the ball back from Horvat, here comes Stan Stolte, and Fuller's afternoon is done after 2 1/3 innings. He's on the hook for the loss if the score were to hold. Nick Rupp coming in to try to keep the score where it is. Michigan State back on top by an 8-7 score. Give you the partial line on Fuller and the numbers on Rupp last year and in his only outing this year when we return to the top of the eighth inning here from Earl E. Wilson Stadium. Michigan State back on top as Zaid Walker RBI double scoring Trent Farquhar from second base. It's an 8-7 lead. It's Nick Rupp onto the mound. Rupp making his second appearance of the series and of the season. Tossed 2 2/3 scoreless innings in the opening day 4-2 win. Comes in with Walker on second and one down in the top of the eighth inning with the UNLV Rebels trailing. It's Jack Frank takes the first pitch high from Rupp in a left-on-left matchup. Fuller recorded 4 strikeouts over his 2 1/3, but charged with 7 hits and 3 runs all earned thus far. Walker, the final runner charged to him if he were to score. Rupp gets a swing and miss as Frank is 1 of 3 with the walk and an RBI single on the day. Fuller needed 47 pitches to get through 2 1/3. Give up a single, a double, and a home run here in the eighth inning. Two runs across in the frame as Michigan State regains the lead. Ground ball, left side and through. Sneaks over the glove of Diego Alarcon. Grabbed by Krizik in left. The throw is going to be cut off by Alarcon at third. So a 90-foot advancement from Walker. He's now on third base as Jack Frank records his second hit of the game. Talking about the insurance run in the bottom of the seventh for UNLV. Now it's Michigan State looking for an insurance run. After their fourth hit of the inning, runners in the corners with two down. Eric Bajani out with a series of signs for the infielders. Casey Mays, the left fielder, 2-for-4 so far. Rupp, a lefty out of Las Vegas. Attended Spring Valley High School. First pitch slider, cut on and missed. Mays hacking at it. The hands out, backside out swing. He was fooled from the beginning. Singled off of Fuller in the seventh after Acosta struck him out in the fifth. It was 1-for-2 off Josh Sharman, including an RBI single in which he scored in the first inning. Nothing in one. Tapper off the end of the bat. Alarcon dives. He tips it. It sneaks past Horvat. One run's going to score. Rounding second. Heading to third is Frank. Michigan State on top 9-7. Mentioned it earlier. Just goes to show what happens when you put a ball in play. You can't fault Alarcon for trying to dive, but he did not field it cleanly, and Horvat was behind him. As the infield base hit will earn Frank his, or Mays his second RBI of the day. That'll close the book on Fuller as well. He'll be charged with 4 runs. Frank goes first to third on the infield single. Mays with RBI number 2 on the day.
Peter on.
RBI number 5 on the series. He's having a great set. Peter on swings at the first pitch, taps it right back. Grabbed by Rupp, double play at first base. That one was in the air. Doubled up at first is Mays, but the damage done. 5 hits overall in the inning. Michigan State retakes the lead, adds on another run. UNLV comes up in the bottom of the eighth, now trailing by 2. A pressure situation in the bottom of the eighth. It's Kyle Bischoff into the game, following up Kyle Dunning. Bischoff, the right-hander, into face-off against the top of the Rebel lineup here in the bottom of the eighth inning. It was a 3-spot in the top of the eighth for Michigan State to not only take the lead, but add 2 insurance runs. 9 runs on 14 hits for the visitors, 7 on 8 for UNLV. trying to put a bow on this eighth inning. It was three runs on five hits. One man left on as the double play wiped out any more scoring chances. On popped out. Mays was frozen off the bag at first. Charles Alarcon Krizik, top three batters in the Rebel lineup against Bischoff, whose first pitch is a knee-high heater to the left-handed batting Charles for a called strike. The final line on Kyle Dunning, who's the pitcher of record, due for the win if the score holds. Three hitless and scoreless innings. He did walk two and strike out three. Charles fouls the breaking ball down into his foot, walking it off beyond the first base bag. It took Dunning 44 pitches to get through those three innings. I venture to say that 70% of those pitches were off speed. He had the big breaking curveball working. And Peyton Fuller's line is now final as well. With the eighth inning wrapped up, Fuller 2 1/3, four runs all earned on seven hits, no walks and four strikeouts over 47 pitches. He's in line for the loss if the 9-7 score holds. The 0-2 to Charles. Fought off the other way, down the left field line it goes, charging his maze. Watches it drop on the warning track in front of the bullpen on the left field side. Bischoff, a 6'2" right-hander, native of Macomb, Michigan, transfer from Toledo, who pitched 50 innings and 41 appearances for the Rockets, including 66 strikeouts. Charles picks up the bat, back in from the left side. Bischoff, the right-hander, ahead, nothing and two. Everybody deep around the infield. Charles takes a pitch just outside. Good watch with two strikes. The former Toledo Rocket, Kyle Bischoff. Fires to the Reno native, Rylan Charles, who takes a called ball two inside. Off the mound was Bischoff. He thought he had strike three. Instead, count goes all square at deuces. Charles has reached base every time he's been up, twice via the benefit of a hit. Swings, line drive, right center field. That'll split the outfielders and roll all the way to the wall. Charles zooming around first. He's thinking three, slams on the brakes around second, probably smartly so, with Farquhar catching the relay with plenty of momentum towards the third base bag. The leadoff hitter doubles. You don't want to be overly aggressive in a two-run ball game in that situation. Good piece of hitting by Charles, taking that high fastball to the right center field gap. Knew it was too out of the box. You can see, picked up the sign early from the third base coach, Kevin Higgins. Picture perfect technique. You want to look before you get to the bag. Know what you're doing so you can adjust your turn around second base. Especially as the leadoff man, don't hate the decision to stay at second at all. Brings up Diego Alarcon, representing the game's tying run in the bottom of the eighth inning. Third baseman Clark creeping. Alarcon hit by the pitch. Tying run on base with no outs. That one hit him right in the meat of the back. He'll feel it tomorrow, but for today, he earns his way on late in this contest. Alarcon almost nodding as he was hit, as if to say, all right, let's go. Charles on second, Alarcon on first. Here comes a mound visit from the pitching coach, Mark Vanamee. Austin Krizik with a chance to get off the schneid. He's 0 for 4 with three strikeouts. Would all be forgotten if he's able to put a ball in play here. The meeting of all the infielders on top of the mound, as there's a right-hander getting loose for Michigan State down the left field line. The Rebels have been fighting all day. They were down 4-0 after one. Heading into their at-bat in the bottom of the second, they were down 5-0. The Rebels then put up 3 in the 3rd, a Hank Zeisler home run in the third. Followed up by a 3-spot in the 5th, including a Cole Andevolge 2-run blast.
Austin Krizik.
3 runs in the top of the inning have Michigan State on top 9-7, but the Rebels threatening. A Rylan Charles double followed up by the Diego Alarcon hit by pitch. Here's Krizik. Needs to put something in play, namely to the outfield. First and second, no outs in a 2-run ball game. Squares to bunt. Gets it down the third base side. A good job by Bischoff coming off the mound. Throwing low. It's off the bag Farquhar keeps it in front, but everybody's going to be safe. An infield base hit on a bunt from Austin Krizik loads the bags with no outs here in the bottom half of the eighth inning. Look who's coming to the plate. It's Hank Zeisler, who went yard earlier.
Zeisler
would be high time for a Zeisler drive. He's walked twice, other than the home run, leads the team with four walks so far. Nowhere to put him, bases loaded, nobody out. First pitch in for a strike on the inner half. Zeisler was the man at Chapman, a national champion in the Division III level in 2019. He was the series MVP as well. He comes up big in pressure situations. The 0-1, swung on, hit right to the third baseman Kark. His throw to the plate is in time. Zeisler hustling to first, he's out. A double play, no run score. Krizik to second, Alarcon to third. The tying run is in scoring position with two down. Heads up play by Dylan Kark. That was a rocket right at him on one hop. He knew that he had time to take a look. Gave a peek to second, instead fired to the plate. A 5-2 put out at home. Zeisler retired 2-3 at first. Alarcon on third, Krizik on second once again. Here's Andovolgi. Fastball right down the pipe, a tough one to watch, especially from Bischoff, who's a big-time late-inning reliever. Seven runs for UNLV on 10 hits. The next one could be the biggest one yet. And Avolgi swings late on the heater. He was sitting on something soft. Instead, the fastball blown by him, and he's behind nothing and two. And Avolgi, a two-run homer and two walks to go along with the strikeout. Outfield deep, the pitch. Outside, swinging around to the right is the catcher, Brecker. A ball and two strikes to Andovolgi in his second start of the set. Was the game one starter behind the plate in game one yesterday, serving as a designated hitter here in the series finale. Bischoff set, the 1-2 pitch. Down and away, a good watch from Andovolgi as that one started in the zone and moved out. If Cole can find a way to reach base, Adarian Williams awaits on deck. He's one of three so far today. Plenty of room down the left field line. They're playing Andovolgi to go the opposite way. 2-2 pitch hit up in that direction, foul territory. Right fielder Walker will give it a run over there, but instead he'll watch it fall beyond the right field UNLV bullpen. Nobody up in the pen as of yet. Nick Rupp came in and got an inning-ending double play to wrap up the top of the eighth. Michigan State with a right-hander just in case up and tossing. After the foul ball, the count remains 2-2. Krizik, the tying run on second base with Alarcon ahead of him at third. Bischoff's pitch cut on and missed. Andovolgi set down on strikes. Bases loaded, no outs. Rebels are not able to get anything out of it. And we're on to the ninth inning. Michigan State due up, leading by two. You're watching UNLV Baseball. disappointing ending to the bottom of the eighth inning for UNLV. Bases loaded, no outs. A double play and a strikeout later. We're in the ninth with Michigan State still leading by a 9-7 tally. Second frame of work begins for Nick Rupp with the fastball, high and away to the right-handed batting catcher Brian Brecker. It's the first inning that Rupp has started on the mound. Came in the eighth inning, gave up two hits, but got an inning-ending double play. One of his inherited runners scored. This one shot foul by Brecker. Peyton Fuller, the final run on his ledger, was actually allowed by Rupp, but it goes to Fuller on the scorecard. Four runs for Fuller in two and a third innings. Here's the 1-1. Brecker takes up and away. Bijani tried to frame it back in, but not to be. 7, 8, and 9 due up for Michigan State here in the top of the final frame of the final game of a four-game series to kick off the 2022 season. Nick Rupp fires. Fastball low, called for a ball. 3-1 the count to Brecker, who's 1 of 3 today. Rupp, a Las Vegas native, attended CSN, College of Southern Nevada, for 2 years before transferring to Houston. Was brought back home by Stan Stolte and the coaching staff. 3-1 pitch hit on the ground, left side and through. Sneaks between Horvat and Alarcon. And Brian Brecker with his second hit of the game. It's the third time that he's reached base. Third hit allowed by Rupp as well, but he's spread it out and has done a good job of coming back when he does give up the hits. So here's Stan Stolte, the manager out. As
first baseman, Brock.
Going to have a word with the home plate umpire.
Yeah.
Interesting there. Not sure what that was about. Brock Vredenberg. Due in from the left side. Vredenberg with a triple and nothing else. Grounded out to second and short along with a backwards K in the sixth inning. Left-on-left matchup here with a runner on. Rupp tried to start the curveball high. It stayed high and a bit up and inside of Vredenberg. Infield's deep with the exception of Horvat, maybe a step or two in and towards the bag up the middle. 1-0 curveball. Rupp right down the middle for a called strike. Ball and a strike, the count to the first baseman, Vredenberg. Wearing number 28, native of Pasadena in Southern California. Rupp's 1-1, swung on and missed as Vredenberg laid around on the heater. He's been fooled by some fastballs here in the series. Big body, you got a lot of levers and a lot of moving parts. Big body if there ever was one at 6'7", 232. Rupp ahead, a ball and two strikes. He fires. Curveball. Line deep to right field. Sharman back. He'll turn around and watch it sneak over the fence. A home run for Brock Vredenberg has made it a four-run game in the top of the ninth inning. Vredenberg's second home run of the series. He now has 8 RBIs through 4 games of the season.
Third baseman.
That one got out of here in a hurry. The question was is whether or not it was going to kiss the top of the wall and come back in. That thing was on a line from the second it left the bat. Vredenberg's 2 hits today, a triple in the second, and a homer in the top of the ninth inning. Expanding the lead to 4 runs. And it'll bring in the bottom of the lineup in Dylan Kark, who homered earlier. Eric Bijani out to slowly work his way out to Rupp as another southpaw gets going in the bullpen. Noah Matera, wearing number 41, getting loose. You remember Hayden Nierman was supposed to come in and start the fourth inning. Had to come out before he even threw a pitch. He was in his final warm-up tosses and came up clutching the shoulder. And that's going to be it for Rupp. The Vredenberg home run, the end of the line, as the manager Stan Stolte out. A quick point to the bullpen. So Rupp lifted after recording just 2 outs, both of them in the 8th inning. Doesn't get an out in the 9th and gives up the Vredenberg home run. UNLV trailing 11-7. It's Matera coming in to try to keep the score that way. We'll be back in a moment from Earl E. Wilson Stadium. Noah Matera, another lefty out of the Rebel bullpen. In with no outs, two runs across already in the top of the ninth inning. Michigan State on top 11-7. Nick Rupp recorded two outs, both on a double play in the eighth inning. Give you his final line in a moment. It's Dylan Karkin from the right side. Matera's first pitch, tapped down the third base side. That'll trickle foul, touched up by Alarcon. Rupp made it two-thirds of an inning, did not record an out in the ninth. Gave up two runs, both on the Vredenburg long ball. Two of the four hits he allowed were in the ninth. Didn't walk a batter, didn't strike out a batter. Over 16 pitches. The 1-2. The fastball called for a strike. Count now nothing and two. Kark homered to left field in his last time up. A high shot that just cleared the fence. The nothing and two pitch. Outside. One ball, two strikes the count. Kark has grounded out twice to third. He drove in a run back in the second on one of those ground outs to Diego. He also flied out to left as part of the seven-batter run scoring sixth inning off of Fuller. His fastballs pop way high but shallow to right center field. Coming in is Sharman. Jason Sharman makes the grab at the waist. It was Darian Williams spinning around out there. Now the outfielder was there to make the catch as Kark retired for the first out here in the ninth inning. Back to the top of the lineup, it's Trent Farquhar and then Mitch Jebb. Back-to-back lefties following Kark, part of the reason why Matera was the one up after Rupp. Matera working exclusively out of the stretch with nobody on, gets a big swing and a bigger miss. A foul ball straight back into the mitt. Matera, a Moorpark, California native, making his second appearance of the 2022 season. Farquhar pops one up on the left side. That'll find the seats. Matera was the first man out of the bullpen in game one of the doubleheader yesterday. Made it just two-thirds of an inning, faced three batters, and struck out two of them. Gave up a hit and a run as well. Farquhar taps one to Darian Williams at second base. He'll glove turn and fire in plenty of time to nail the speedy second baseman. Michigan State with two outs in the top of the ninth inning. Sending up Mitch Jebb to the plate with nobody on. Sixth plate appearance of the afternoon for Jebb. He's got a hit, two walks, and a fielder's choice to go along with a ground out to second off of Fuller in the eighth. Fuller on the hook for the loss if the score holds. First pitch in a left-on-left. Jebb squares to bunt, pulls it back on a breaking ball that's called for a strike. Matera made eight appearances out of the pen last year, was knocked around a bit over his 13 innings. Gave up 19 runs on 25 hits while striking out 11. Opponents batted 379 against him, looking to turn it around here this year. His 0-1, Jebb squares again, pulls it back on a pitch, the fastball downstairs. Looking ahead to the bottom of the ninth, Williams, Bajani, and Jason Sharman, the first three batters, due up to try to begin the comeback bid. Here's the 1-1. Nice-looking pitch that started in the zone and falls outside, called for ball two. Matera, in his first season with the Rebels in 2020, was in the rotation more so before the COVID-19 pandemic stopped the season in March. Another off-speed pitch. This one called for a strike to bring the count 2-2. In that 2020 season, 11 innings, he gave up just 12 runs with six punch-outs and nine walks. Third year with the program. Count all square at two to Mitch Jebb. Pitcher set. Matera fires and misses just outside. Bajani didn't handle it cleanly. And now the count full is Jebb patient here, drawing the pitches out of Matera, looking for the one that he wants, with visitors leading by four. Wynn would clinch the four-game set by 3-1 margin. Everybody a step to the right. Here comes the 3-2 payoff. Popped up, deep to center field. Going back is Charles. Stops, looks up, reaches up, and makes the catch. Brock Vredenburg with a two-run home run to expand the lead. When we come back, the Rebels batting in the bottom of the ninth inning. They need four to tie, five to walk it off and win. We'll see if they can do it. Don't go anywhere. Bottom of the ninth upcoming. It all comes down to this. We're in the bottom of the ninth inning. Rebels trailing by four. Michigan State leading by an 11-7 score. It'll be a Darian Williams to lead things off. Zach Iverson, the new first baseman, coming in for Brock Vredenberg, who went yard to expand the lead to four. Second inning of work for Kyle Bischoff begins with a breaking ball, moving over the entirety of the plate, called for a strike to Williams.
That's Darian Williams.
Darian's one of three, singled, struck out twice, and was hit by a pitch in the fifth. Watching all the way on 0-1, a fastball up and away, called for ball one. Brian Brecker singled ahead of Vredenberg, so it was a two-run home run. Noah Matera came in and retired the next three batters he faced in order. Put out the fire as Williams watches a strike. 1-2 the count to Adarian, the number six batter in the lineup, as Eric Bajani awaits on deck. Pitch tapped, or missed rather, it's by the catcher. Williams is going to advance to first. So it goes as a strikeout for Bischoff, but Williams reaches first base on the wild pitch. They're going to give the catcher Brecker a passed ball. You could hear it hit something, but it was the catcher's gear of Brecker. It went right through the mitt. Thought I heard something to indicate a foul ball, but instead, Williams down to the first on the drop third strike. Eric Bajani in from the right, takes a called strike on a fastball at the knees. Bajani needing to start the rally here with a runner on. Swings late on the breaking ball, knocks it straight back into the screen. The on-deck batter Jason Sharman still out there. He's the right fielder, the eighth batter in the lineup. Gianni Horvat awaiting in the hole. A three-man shift on the left side of the infield against Bajani, who is a pull hitter but can go the other way just as easily. Behind nothing and two. Pitch from Bischoff, way up and away, a good waist pitch. Bischoff not able to induce the swing. A single for Bajani in the fifth inning. Extended the three-run frame. As he takes a called third strike, he was already digging in for the next pitch. Backwards K is the first out of the ninth, albeit the second strikeout. With the Darian Williams on first after the passed
right
ball.
Jason Sharman. Attention, please. Now playing first base.
One out, one on. It's Jay Sharman. Batting from the left. He's one of three with a walk. Iverson holding on at first. He was the opening day starter on the mound. Sharman watching the first pitch all the way, taking from the jump. It's a called strike on the heater at the knees. Bischoff gets ahead. Iverson has played in three of the four games now. Played first twice. He again started the opening day game on the mound. Nicely spotted fastball, painting the black on the outside is Kyle Bischoff, and he's ahead of the second consecutive batter, nothing and two. Bajani was in the indication he's going to go up, and he does. There is a pinch hitter awaiting on deck. It's number eight, Santino Panero, who had a pair of hits as pinch hitter yesterday. 1-2, inside, called for ball two. The entirety of the Michigan State bullpen was ready to celebrate the second out of the inning. They were jumping up nearly out of their dugout, but instead a great watch by Sharman, who singled and scored in the second. Leans away from a fastball, no call. Ball three. The count full with one down, trailing by four. Would not expect to see a Darian Williams near the first base bag for too long. Let's see what Sharman does here with Santino Panero awaiting on deck. Pitch called outside, ball four. You can't score four runs to tie without runners on base. Williams and Sharman have done just that without the benefit of a hit. Williams in scoring position on second. It's Sharman to first with Gianni Horvat pinch hit for here.
For Horvat, number eight.
Santino Panero, the Bishop Gorman product, in from the left.
Santino Panero.
One out, two on. Game's tying run is on deck in the form of Ryland Charles, who's been blazing hot. Got to bring him up in this situation. Another first pitch strike on a fastball for Bischoff. He started off all four batters of the inning with a heater right down the pipe. They've all watched it. It's been called for a strike. There is something to be said about working pitches in a late-game pressure situation, but Panero watches here on another called strike. Nothing and two the count. It's the third batter out of four this inning. That started out nothing and two. And again, both Bajani and Williams got high fastballs way out of the zone on 0-2s. Bischoff steps off, looks at second. So Horvat's day ends 0 for 4. He did reach on a fielder's choice and score. Panero singled and doubled in two at-bats in the nightcap yesterday after coming in as a pinch hitter in the sixth. Goes down, golfs this one, a swinging bunt down the first base side. Picked up in fair territory. He's safe at first. Everybody safe all around. Iverson livid. He thinks Panero ran in front. Bischoff likely should have let that one roll foul. That thing was still moving when he picked it up. And that's a tough play. That's as tough a play as it gets for a pitcher. Take a look. That thing was moving still when he picked it up. Yeah, Panero has a right to the base path. He ran to the middle of the bag. He's safe. The umpire's meeting here, and I believe that's what they're talking about, is whether or not Panero went in. We have the benefit of replay to see that he went right down the middle of the bag. They're going to call everybody safe. Great job by Panero to hustle down the line. That'll bring up Ryland Charles representing the tying run in the bottom of the ninth inning with the bases loaded. They're going to give Panero an infield single. Williams to third, Sharman to second, Panero to first. And Ryland Charles has not been retired today. Three hits, including a single, or two singles and a double, a walk, and a fielder's choice. One down, bases loaded in the bottom of the ninth. Charles grounds the first pitch up the middle. Grabbed by Jeb, the shortstop takes it to the bag himself. The feed to first is in time. Ryland Charles grounds into the game-ending 6-4 double play. And while the Rebels threatened, they're unable to accomplish the comeback, needing four in the bottom of the ninth as they drop the fourth and final game of the series by a four spot, 11-7. They drop the series 3-1. We'll step aside. When we return, we'll wrap it up on our Finley Chevy postgame show right here from Earl E. Wilson. Matt and Everett welcoming you back to Earl E. Wilson Stadium for the final time today. The Rebels meeting down the right field line after a back-and-forth game ultimately pulled out by the visiting Michigan State Spartans, who win the third game out of four in the series. UNLV won 4-2 on opening day. Losses by 10-6 and 12-6 scores yesterday, and an 11-7 loss today to fall to 1-3 to start the year. Michigan State, 11 runs on 16 hits. They made one error defensively and left 9 men on base, and UNLV scored 7 runs on 11 hits. They made 3 errors defensively and also left 12 men on base. That was the issue in the games yesterday. They did a better job today. The Rebels were fighting back after being down 5-0, heading into their at-bat in the bottom of the second. They scored 3 in the second, another run in the third, the 3 more in the fifth inning were the final runs of the game. They only had one 1-2-3 inning on the day, though. The Rebels did a better job of situational hitting today than in the doubleheader yesterday. Kyle Dunning will get the win in relief for Michigan State, going 3 hitless and scoreless innings on 44 pitches. He walked 2 and struck out 3 to go into 1-0 on the year. Peyton Fuller, in his first appearance in the Scarlet and Gray, takes a defeat, going 2 1/3 innings in relief. He gave up 4 runs, including being charged for 3 of them in the 8th inning. 2 1/3 frames, 4 runs all earned on 7 hits for Fuller. No walks and 4 strikeouts over 47 pitches. We played in 3 hours and 19 minutes in front of 797 fans here on a picture-perfect Sunday afternoon for baseball. The Rebels' next action will be Tuesday. They make the 2-hour drive east to St. George, Utah to take on Dixie State in a one-off game before heading to San Diego to play the University of San Diego in Hawaii in a roundabout tournament before returning to Earl E. Wilson Stadium for their next home game, our next broadcast. It'll be March 1st at 2:05 as former Mountain West foe Utah travels to Las Vegas and Earl E. Wilson Stadium, a 2:05 first pitch and a 2 o'clock pregame show. For our producer, Devin Keenum, SID Kelsey Olson, and everybody else here at UNLV, I'm Matt Neverett saying thank you for tuning in. We'll be back on March 1st when Utah comes to Las Vegas.